So as you've probably seen, I don't do PowerPoint presentations or anything like that. I don't have anything pre-planned. So we can talk about basically anything you want. That's tonight is dog related. So anything that's dog related. So I think we have to officially start 5 o'clock. Is that correct? Yeah, but I can talk to you. Otherwise, you know, I'm just going to sit here looking at you. You're going to sit there looking at me, waiting for the hands to tick round to five. So, you know, people just sort of drift in, I'm hoping, anyway, as this progresses. So just to explain a little bit about myself, I'm actually an aircraft engineer, loosely disguised as a dog trainer. There's no certification for dog trainers really anywhere in the world. I know, you know, there's all kinds of different bodies of people that claim that they certify dog trainers. We've had a big problem in the UK with people posing as dog trainers and then taking money from the general public. So we have two people that said they were dog trainers in prison at this moment in time for it's called obtaining money under false pretenses. In other words, they said in their little write-up on the internet all the things that they'd done with dogs, and it turned out actually the two people concerned never even owned a dog. You know, but they work for all these animal charities, they've done it. So in every country we get people that can call themselves dog trainers. There's only one real certification anywhere that I would be interested in, and that's an international one. Up until that happens, again, it's just like reading dog books. It's very confusing. So many different people claiming to be dog trainers. You know, someone who says I've been training dogs for 50 years, but it doesn't mean they've been doing it very well, does it? They've just been doing it for 50 years. So, yep.
And John, so there's a difference between behaviorist and trainer, right?
Okay. Okay. This is now a difficult one. Do you want to answer? This is a difficult one, Mia. You can answer it. And she'll answer in Chinese. If it's a hard one, I'll get Mia to answer it in Chinese. Okay. Let me see if I can only give you my description of trainer behaviorist, which probably wouldn't be accepted by some of the behaviorists and probably wouldn't be accepted by some of the trainers. A trainer is someone who knows how to teach the dog to do something. So I could show you, well, we did for 3 days, showed people how to train dogs to come back when they were called. We showed people how to train the dogs to stay when they were told. So a dog trainer is able to do that. I'm going to stick my neck out and say a behaviorist is someone who can retrain a dog. So it's already learnt the wrong behavior, and they've now got to remove the bad behavior and replace it with a good behavior. So that's my definition. The British National Kennel Club, which actually holds the only certification recognized by any government in the world, what they've said is you can't be a behaviorist unless you're first a dog trainer. So there is no behavior qualification in the UK unless you first get a qualification as a dog trainer. It's the only international certification for dog trainers and behaviorists anywhere in the world. And it's because our government was becoming more and more worried about people because of television programs. You know, I can do that. I've never owned a dog before, but I've seen it on television. You can do it all in 5 minutes. I can do that and take people's money. So we've had a lot of people, a whole spate of people, because of television programs that have done that. So our government started to become concerned about implications for a dog's welfare when it was being seen by someone who had no qualifications, no training whatsoever. So they, on their advice, our kennel club started up a certification for dog trainers and behaviorists. You can find, actually, it's international. We've just had the first international commendation, a girl in India, who single-handedly changed the whole culture of dog training in India. Up until she came on the scene, the training was incredibly brutal. So she changed everything. She's just got this big international commendation. Okay, so the first thing, dog training, dog behavior. The first thing I'm going to tell you is I have no academic qualifications to be sat in front of you talking about dogs and dog behavior. The only qualification I ever got at school, because I left school when I was 16, I didn't go to university, it's people that aren't very clever that go to university, isn't it? Just joking. Trying to start getting into an argument straight away. So I left school when I was 16. The only qualification I got, I passed an exam in woodwork. So I actually have a certificate in woodwork, age 16. I do lecture at universities all around the world. But the problem is, especially since about 1980, we've made dog behaviour incredibly complicated. Where now, again, I teach in universities, you have to go to university to learn about simple dog behaviour. Dogs are incredibly simple animals. It is incredibly simple to change their behaviour, and as most people saw when they came on the course, the 3-day course, Friday, Saturday and Sunday, it is incredibly quick and easy to train them, isn't it? There's absolutely nothing to it. I have a book written in 1754. First book, I didn't write it. The first book I've been able to find on the on dog training, it was called Dog Breaking. So 1754 it was written, and the first words in the book are, dog training is an art that is easily acquired. And it is, but we've complicated it. We've complicated it by the language we now use in dog training. You know, people start talking about these ridiculous words, positive reinforcement, negative reinforcement, active and passive avoidance learning. We're not gonna do any of that tonight. I actually, in the university, I have to teach, it's usually a whole section on the theory of learning. But that's all it is, it's theory. So I could do that lecture now. Actually, it would take probably a total of about 16 hours. All that would happen is people would fall asleep, and it wouldn't make anyone here a better dog trainer, and you wouldn't understand dogs any better anyway. So we're going to make this. I've got to do 50 years of my work in the space of, because we're nearly ready to start, 2 hours. So as I say, the evening will go any way that you want it to go in the time we have available. What I'm hoping to cover is, first of all, a little bit on cultural differences in the way that different cultures view dogs, train them, in dog behaviour in different countries of the world. And I'll condense that down. It's usually about a 1-hour talk. We'll condense it down to about 5 minutes. If you look at the behaviour of children in any culture around the world, that's the behaviour of children in terms of their obedience to their parents, their respect for older people, respect for property. It's absolutely mirrored in the behaviour of dogs in that culture, because they have the same role models, don't they? Or they have had up until recently. Now it's becoming less and less common for the owners of a dog to be its role model. It's becoming less and less common. Certainly in America, we're just going to do a quick hands up, but no one look round. I'm guessing a lot of you own more than one dog. So how many people here own more than one dog? Oh, right, okay. So straight away, that's where we start to have problems. Any culture of the world where you see owners owning more than one dog, you'll start to see a dramatic increase in things that we call dog behavior problems, or a dog that the owner can't control. So culturally, in the UK, I can talk about that extensively because that's where I come from. Our tradition of dog ownership, the same as originally in the USA, you know, when the settlers came, the tradition was the family would own the dog. It would be born locally. You wouldn't pay anything for it, would you? And it would probably be a mutt. It would be a dog that had been developed for that community, for that diet. So we had all these dogs. In the UK, we had dogs like that. Something dramatic happened, and it started in the UK around 1948, 1949, where people, for some reason, after the Big Depression, and money started to come into people's pockets. So this is now a bit more of a disposable income. First thing that people do in any culture when that happens is they will want to buy more expensive dogs. They'll want to buy pedigree breeds of dogs that come from countries that don't have the same culture as we have. So we used to have a lot of breeds of dog that were fantastic companion dogs in the UK. All now extinct. All extinct breeds. The Gredin, Toy Trawler Terrier, the Toy Decoy Dog, the Comforter, the Turnspit, all now extinct. And we've replaced them in pet homes with breeds like How about the Russian Black Terrier or a Weimaraner? So someone in the UK who wants a family companion will now go and buy a Weimaraner and pay a huge amount of money for it. We've seen it happen in lots of other countries where we abandon our traditional dogs. Also the family would own one dog. Before lots of air travel, a family vacation would be traveling on in the UK on a bus or on a train to usually a coastal resort, and you would take your dog with you. You would take the dog everywhere with you. The dog was part of the family. When it eventually grew old and passed away, the family would then make a decision about getting another one. They want one the same. We didn't have trainers, we didn't have behaviorists, they weren't needed. Actually, we didn't have very many veterinarians then because they weren't needed. So that culture started to change, and it changed because of one book in the UK. There was a company producing dog biscuits. These were the days, by the way, when a family dog ate what the family ate. That actually around the world, that's becoming less and less common. That we're actually segregating the dog as part of the family because we're feeding them something that we don't eat. That's never happened in all of our history, but it started to happen now. So a little booklet was published, and it was called The Sprat's Guide to Dog Management in the UK. And it had a whole chapter devoted to how to choose a puppy. If anyone has an interest, I could teach you how to choose a puppy that would be the best dog you could ever own. It would never end up in a shelter. So we might be able to get round to doing that. So when this book was published, it talked about the pride in owning a pedigree dog. And it said things like, someone who owns a pedigree breed of dog is more likely to be concerned for its welfare and look after it better. Now go and have a look at shelters. So that wasn't true. So in that booklet, it actually turned the whole of our population away from owning a family pet mutt that was bred in the area to pedigree dogs being more desirable, purebred dogs being more desirable. In the USA, it was Helen Woodhouse Walker who did a demonstration of obedience with her poodles at one of the big Westminster shows. And the reason she did it with poodles was there was this feeling in the USA, all the vaudeville acts that were going around, they'd always have a guy with performing dogs. They were always mutts. So in the USA, there was this mistaken belief that pedigree dogs looked beautiful but had no brains. It was the mutts that had the brains. So that's why obedience competition started in the USA. And that's why when they started, you weren't allowed to take part with a mutt. Because if the mutts won, it would have only proven the point that the purebred dogs were stupid. So interesting how it actually worked out. So that was the first book in the UK, or booklet, that actually started to turn our population away from the traditional family pet dog that served a purpose, and away to buying pedigree breeds of dog. Spratt's Dog Food Company, they just sold dog biscuits basically, and all kinds of cures for every possible disease your dog could have. And it was bought out by another company, so another company took over. And the name of that company? Pedigree Pet Foods. Wasn't an accident, was it? Pedigree Pet Foods. Okay, so that changed our culture. So then we have, in dog training classes, I started as an instructor in 1966 in London. So in our dog training class, we'd have local dogs that came in. These were companion dogs. And then what started to happen, we'd start to see purebred dogs coming in to a pet dog training class. So you'd have someone with a border collie. They bought it as a family pet. A border collie is a family pet. And a border collie that has never, ever been developed in our culture to live in someone's house. Border collies don't live in people's houses. Border collies live outside in a barn, and they work all day long. It's one of the breeds I love. I've owned them for 50 years. It's also a breed I hate because they screw up people's lives quicker than most other breeds. So we did some research on border collies in a hill farm in Derbyshire, and an average border collie on a hill farm runs 75 miles on an average day. And people buy and want to keep an apartment, and they want to keep the dog in the house, take it out for a walk twice a day for 250 yards or 250 meters when the weather's cold, and they wonder why they start to get problems with it. Okay, so first thing, this is what's changed in your culture, it's changed in mine, is people are taking on breeds that are totally inappropriate for their lifestyle. It's the first mistake that people make. That's why we have shelters all around the world, and we fill them with more and more dogs. These are dogs that are unsuitable for that environment. Our customs and immigration. So if you come through Heathrow Airport, probably not if you flew in from Jackson Hole, Wyoming, but if you come from somewhere like Colombia, Nigeria, you're more likely to be confronted by a customs dog that is searching out drugs. Where do they get their dogs from? They get them from shelters. So this would be a Springer Spaniel that someone's taken on, work from working lines, and they wanted to be a family pet. The dog doesn't have a job to do, and so it starts to get mischievous. The owners then turn it into a shelter, typically between about 8 months and 14 months, because they can't do a thing with it. It's a bad dog, isn't it? Our customers get that, give the dog a job of work to do, so they don't pay anything for these dogs, they get them from shelters, and that dog does a remarkable job of work. The difference between that dog being in a shelter, okay, in the original home being considered useless, and the dog doing a brilliant job of work protecting our borders, one word, it's called training. Just training dogs. With working breeds of dog, they require some training. So we need to talk about two types of behavior that we're interested in. And there's only two types to be interested in. One type of behavior is called genetic. Pre-programmed in at birth. Inflexible to any kind of body behavior modification program. Okay? I cannot modify a Doberman's behavior to turn it into a golden retriever. I can't do that. I cannot modify a Springer Spaniel's behavior and turn it into a Cavalier King Charles Spaniel. Bred for completely different reasons. So what you have to remember is the breed of dog that you end up with, the one that you get, will have one set of behavior imprinted in its DNA code. So I can tell you, so let's look at a few breeds. So with my Border Collie puppy, at 16 weeks, you should start to see the genetic instinct of it becoming more and more interested in movement. So we have the Shepherd in Scotland, who takes a Border Collie out of a litter of puppies, and he raises it, he trains it around sheep. And that dog, when it gets to 2 years of age, wins an international sheepdog competition. And we get someone else who buys a Border Collie from the same litter, same genetic material, and they keep it in an apartment in London. And at 18 months of age, it is put to sleep for aggression problems. It's lunging at cars. When the owner tries to stop it, it bites the owner. It's called redirected aggression. Born out of frustration, because it's not allowed to be a Border Collie in London. And the owner blames the Border Collie, or they'll blame the breeder, won't they? Okay, German Shepherd, typical German Shepherd. And if you look at what a German Shepherd was bred to do, this gives you all the clues. Look at what your dog was actually bred to do. So typical German Shepherd, someone knocks on the door, the dog explodes into barking. So you get hold of the dog's collar, invite them in, they come in and sit down. We sit down, have a cup of tea, have a talk. And now it's time for my friend to leave. He gets up, the dog bites him when he goes out. It's supposed to. It's a German Shepherd. Okay? So it shouldn't be, if you know about German Shepherd, it shouldn't be a surprise to you. And then I run a training class, and people have arrived. You know, we've got a few dogs there. And I go up, and I just want to check your dog's collar, make sure it's safe. And it's a Rottweiler. Not that Rottweilers are aggressive, but genetically, you know what a Rottweiler was used for? They could drive a huge number of cattle to market. And when the cattle were sold, the money, because it wasn't credit cards in those days, the money would be put in a leather pouch. The pouch was attached to the dog's collar. Genetically, they're actually sensitive to their collar. Now, don't worry. It doesn't mean every Rottweiler in the world, you can't touch its collar. But I'm saying it's one of the breeds, unless I knew it, I'd be less like. I wouldn't touch a lot of dogs, you know, when I first met them. So these are genetic instincts. You cannot modify those instincts. Sorry. If you're a breeder, you can modify those instincts. So you could pick a Rottweiler that had an outstanding behavioral disposition, completely non-aggressive to people, non-aggressive like kids, and you could make that to a female, and after 10 generations, you'd end up with a whole load of soft Rottweilers, as we found in the UK when they brought in the 1991 Dangerous Dogs Act. I was seeing 20, usually male Rottweilers a week with aggression problems, until one person single-handedly, it's only a small island I live on, one person single-handedly decided that our government was going to ban Rottweilers, because we banned four breeds of dog, and Rottweilers were next on the list. And he brought out something called the temperament tests, the Rottweiler character assessment, where you could take your Rottweiler and have its temperament assessed. The ones that passed his assessment, he gave them a certificate. Those are the ones that the general public sought because they knew they were going to get a dog of good temperament. By 1995, I wasn't seeing any aggression problems in Rottweilers. They're very, very soft-natured in the UK now. So breeders are able, by very carefully selectively breeding dogs, they're able to change temperament a little bit. Most won't do it because they concentrate more on appearance. And it's breed standards which defines exactly what a dog should look like that have killed so many breeds of dog, both mentally and, I'm going to have to say, physically. So, selecting a dog. You cannot modify in any shape or form genetically driven behavior. I'll quickly give you the example. I can't believe we've already gone through 14 minutes. Right, I'll speed up. I'll quickly give you the example. Someone arrives at my dog training class. Oh, sorry, I'm moving around. Okay. Someone arrives at my dog training class with a young Doberman, 10 months of age, and they say, I've got a few problems with my Doberman, things I don't like, can you help me to change? Of course I can. What don't you like? He says, his nose has grown too long. I like the look of a boxer. He's also grown too tall. I don't like that dark colour in his coat. I want it light and fluffy. And if you can shorten him by 3 inches, that'd be perfect. You'd all agree, as a dog trainer or as a dog behaviourist, I can't do anything to help them. They should have known before they purchased that puppy what it was going to look like. Now forget that. The next guy comes in with a 10-month-old Doberman and he says, every time I put my dog outside in the backyard by itself and someone walks past the fence, he runs up and down the fence barking like crazy, and I'm frightened the dogs are going to jump over the fence and bite someone. 10 months of age. I can't change that behavior any more than I can change the color of its coat. It's a Doberman. That is what it is supposed to do. But what I can do, two things that I'm able to do with genetically driven behavior. Number one, I can go out there with the dog and keep it on a lead so it can't do that. That's called management. You want to stop your dog jumping up, stealing food off the counters? Don't leave food on the counters. That's called management. Simple solution. You want to stop kids coming up and cuddling your dog because he doesn't like children? Put a big basket muzzle on, spray the outside with shaving foam. Children won't go anywhere near your dog. And if they do, the parents smack them. Okay, so I can control any genetic instinct mechanically. I can use good management. So when my German Shepherd, so he's allowed someone to come in, and before my guest leaves, I can put the dog in another room and close the door. And then I can allow him to leave. With my Border Collie, I can keep it on a lead. Remember, strong genetic instinct, if I use management, physically controlling the dog, I'm going to end up with a dog that gets frustrated. And frustration is one of the components, key components, towards aggression, isn't it? If you frustrate a dog, it's more likely to become aggressive. Ask anyone who does agility with Border Collies. The number of people that do agility with Border Collies get bitten on the legs by their own dog. Because they put it over jumps, they run it down a line of jumps, the dog now gets overexcited, over-aroused, then they put it down a line of jumps, the dog can see a jump there and they call it away from that jump to go through the tunnel. The dog now gets frustrated, barks and bites them. Very, very common in agility. So we know frustration is one of the key components of aggression. So I can control any genetic instinct by keeping the dog on a leash. I can control it by putting it out the way when I have visitors. Dog with strong territorial instinct, before you open the door, put the dog in another room. So we can do that. But usually you get a lot of frustration if it's a strong instinct. The other way I can control an instinct is actually by training the dog. I can train the dog. So I can train my Border Collie to come back when called. I can train my Border Collie to chase a ball instead of chasing cars. So I can train my Doberman to bark and be quiet on command. I can train my German Shepherd before someone leaves to go and lie in his bed. That's just training. Fewer and fewer people actually understand how to train a dog. Fewer people around the world actually understand how to train a dog. You go to a lot of training classes and all they show you is 20 different ways to feed a dog. which is still better than shock collars and prong collars, isn't it? But you know, I'd rather have that than the way we used to do it. Okay, so to understand the behavior of a dog, let's quickly do a little bit of puppy stuff. So I want to go and choose a puppy. Who counseled, so when you choose your puppy, who counseled you on the breeds that would be suitable? Probably nobody. So you did it based on the fact, oh, that I like the look of that dog. So you look at dog magazines, and 99% of all people who go and get a dog, they've got the dog based on appearance. That's all they bought it for, it's based on appearance. If you choose a dog based on appearance, whether it comes from a shelter or it's a puppy, if you choose it based on appearance, it could be aesthetically the most beautiful dog in the whole world. But if it behaves badly, I will guarantee all of your relatives, all of your friends will think it's the ugliest dog they've ever met. If you choose it based on behavior, even an ugly dog is seen in the community to be a beautiful dog if it behaves well. The communities base their knowledge of our dogs on how they behave, not on how they look. I promise you, it's on how they behave. So we know in the UK, and I know it's happened in a lot of places in the USA, you are incredibly lucky at the moment in this place, Wyoming, because you still have some freedom to take dogs out and let them off the lead. Other areas are not so lucky. So more and more in the UK, our freedom to take dogs where we've exercised them off lead for centuries is now being put into question. We're losing more and more areas where we're allowed to take dogs, not because dogs are pooping in these places, doing it because dogs are out of control in these places. That's why we have leash laws. Leash laws don't stop dogs pooping. Leash laws are there to protect the public from dogs that owners cannot control. So let's go and choose a puppy. I'm not sure if you know of the situation surrounding the sale of puppies in the USA, same as in the UK. First of all, it's going to be difficult to find a good breeder. That's going to be very difficult. I've always said, you know, every shelter in the country should have advertisements up for the best breeders in the area, because they're the ones that are not going to end up with dogs coming into the shelter. But generally, you know, you say the word breeder to anyone involved in rescue, and it's a bad word, isn't it? So you have some good breeders. The problem is you also have some very bad ones. How do you know? So it's not uncommon in the USA and in the UK when a litter of puppies is born. So I want an AKC registration because they're more expensive. So a litter of puppies is born, there's only four born in the litter. Of course, I wouldn't register four puppies, would I? With the AKC, I'd register nine, and I'd buy five from a puppy farm, and I've got all the papers now for... Yep, happens in the UK all the time. I know it happens in the USA. So finding a good breed, that's going to be difficult. Next thing is, what we need, and it's just started to happen in the UK, is a counselling service before people get a puppy. It's never worked up to now, but it's just actually starting to take hold because it's such a liability to own a dog in the UK. So a pre-puppy ownership service. This is what's offered. You phone up the number, you're thinking of getting a puppy, and as a family you're asked to sit and discuss what breed you think would be appropriate, and you're asked to come up with a list of five breeds. And what will then happen is the person who comes to your house to counsel you will look up those five breeds, look at your environment, look at your lifestyle, and advise you on the suitability of each one of those breeds. And they might even advise, okay, none of those breeds, and with your lifestyle, none of those breeds would actually be suitable. There are some more suitable breeds. They will then contact breeders, and they'll contact breeders usually with a story. I'm out at work all day. I want to buy a puppy. I want to buy a male Weimaraner on a puppy from you. I don't know anything about the breed, but my kids think they look cute. So that's what we phone up and say to breeders. And almost all the breeders that we phone up, not only will they sell you a puppy, so we're literally out of the house from 9 in the morning till 6 at night, not only will they sell you one, they'll actually try and sell you two, because obviously they need company, don't they? A dog needs another puppy for company. So any breeder who wouldn't sell you two puppies, any breeder who would sell you, would actually sell you a puppy, we discount, and the ones that tell you, well, you're not really the right sort of person, those are the breeders that we would actually go to. So I just want you to think about that. Okay, so we've now contacted a breeder, now what do we do? I'm going to give you a puppy, you'll never need to take it to a dog training class, it'll be the best dog that you could ever own. Some simple rules. So the first thing is, when we go to the breeder's house, because we're going to go to the house, aren't we? We're not going to get it shipped in by air. I mean, that is probably the worst way you can ever get a dog. You need to go to the breeder's house. And the first question that we ask, where are the puppies being raised? If they're being raised in the kennel, I wouldn't buy a puppy. If I wanted to keep it in a kennel, I would. But if I want one to be part of my family, it would have to be raised in the breeder's house. It would have to spend time in a house. That really should. And just think of your tradition of pet dog ownership. That's always the way it has been up until recently. And now suddenly, dogs are being raised in this environment and then being put in a completely different environment, which creates stress. Okay, so I'm going to go to the breeders, and the first thing we're going to do, if the breeder answers the questions the right way, is I'm going to knock on the door and listen. If there's an explosion of barking which can't be controlled by the owner, I wouldn't even go in and see the puppies, because that's not what I want. If I want a dog that will bark like crazy when someone knocks at the door, I would go in and choose a puppy. But I actually don't want that. I do not want a dog to react. And this has now been imprinted from 3 to 6 weeks by its mother. That's exactly what you're going to get. Look at the mother. 50% of her genes are in the puppies, and she is usually the role model for their behavior. So watch this one. There's a knock on the door. She explodes into barking. Every species of animals that live in communities have alarm calls that they use to warn others within the group when there's a predator arriving. So just look at this. We've got a litter of 8 puppies. The breeder comes in every day, feeds them. Mum goes to the breeder wagging her tail. And then, and when mum's out the house, she comes back in by putting a key in a lock and turning it. So that's the sound they hear. She comes in, friend. And the puppies will actually start to wag their tail, and now the breeder comes in, you actually can't leave without the puppies wanting to follow you. Now there's a knock on the door, that's called a discriminatory signal. And what comes in is a complete stranger, and the mother of the puppies does this, we call it a predatory bark. Listen to it again, it's explosive, and it suddenly jumps an octave. Okay, as soon as we, and the puppies instinctively now, mother has said, that's a predator. It's a human, but it's a predator. And mother is taken out because of her bad behavior, because it's possible she'll bite. So she's taken out. One of her roles, one of her 4 roles, is to protect the puppies from predators. So she's taken out. You're now one of these puppies. And this predator comes in and selects one of your brothers and sisters and leaves. With that first puppy, we're going to say it will be worried about people it doesn't know. Worried about visitors to the house. More than anything, usually okay outside, but visitors to the house, because that's what mum's taught it, isn't it? Second puppy to go, seen it happen twice. Third puppy to go, seen it happen 3 times. By the time you get to the 3rd or 4th puppy, there's no behavior in the world that will solve the problem. That puppy has been fear imprinted not to trust anyone that doesn't live in the house. So it only ever will trust its immediate family and no one else. And there's tests that we can do on imprinted behavior. So if you have a dog like that, I'm hoping most of you don't. If you have a dog like that, all we would do is just ask the question. If I come to your house, so I come in, you probably have to hold on to the dog. Come in, sit down, we'll have a discussion, we'll talk. How long do I need to be there before the dog completely relaxes in my company? So he might bark when I first come in. You're holding on to him by the collar. So by completely relaxing, I mean,
how long will I need to be there before, if I do that, the dog won't react to it? And if I stand up and sit down, so if every time I make a movement the dog's reacting to it, how long would I need to be there? So we actually write that time down. So some people have said, well, if you're there for 15 minutes, they'll even bring a toy and start playing with you. It's just 15 minutes.
So we write that time down. If I come, so now, after, we're going to say 3 hours, the dog is fine with me. I don't mean he'll come to me and be stroked. I mean, he treats me as if I'm of no consequence. He ignores me, really. So I've now got that. 3 hours, that's what I've got. I now leave. If I come back 2 days later, does the time lessen? So if it's 3 hours first occasion, is it 2 hours the second occasion? And if it is, we know we can change the dog's behavior. But if I come back 2 days later and it's still 3 hours, and I come back 2 days, it's still 3 hours, it means the dog is not capable of learning to trust anyone but the people it lives with. And there's no behavioral cure. Okay? Well, there's a management cure, isn't there? You know, when people come to the door, put the dog in another room. Then you won't ever have anyone bitten. Okay, yep.
Can I have a question?
Yep.
So what is your take on dogs that are just overly excited to see people? Like, you know, the dog that reacts when you scratch your head, but fearfully, but opposed to the dog that you stand up and the dog is on your heels. Like, what's, like...
Over arousal.
Just like happy, like yep. So excited about meeting people.
Yeah. Look at mother. Always we look at mother. It's role models for behavior. You are the product of your mother's being a role model, and hopefully a lot of you fathers as well. Although that's happening less and less in the UK, isn't it? Father's not there while the child's being raised. Okay, look at the mother. When you go to a breeder's, you must look at the mother. If what you see with her is exactly what you want in your house, and picture that, there's a fair chance that's what you're going to get when you take one of her puppies. If her behaviour, so if you take your kids with you, and she's hanging back and barking at them, why would you take one of her puppies? I certainly wouldn't. So you want you to just keep looking at mother. Next, we have to look at the environment. So when I walk in, I'm assuming the puppies are in here. When I walk in, I think the important thing is we look at the floor. Wherever the puppies are, there should be two surfaces, two separate surfaces. One surface, which is two-thirds of the area, where usually X-Pen or something, two-thirds of this surface should be a surface you'd find in my house. So it would be carpet, linoleum, wood flooring. Two-thirds of the surface. One-third of the surface on the floor should be something you'd never find on the floor in my house. Typically, that would be newspaper. 3 weeks of age onwards, mother will actually house train the puppies. It's just a discrimination process. So this is what she'll do. 3 weeks of age, when they start to eat more solid food, then up until then she keeps them clean. What we're looking for is a water bowl on the carpet, bedding on the carpet where they sleep. We'll talk about toys later. There has to be a lot of toys on that carpet. That's where they're going to get fed. That's an alternative surface. Mother will teach them to defecate on the paper. So when you take the puppy home, it's already paper trained. See, people in the UK would never toilet train the puppy by putting it in a crate. It would be considered incredibly cruel to do that. You just do it by using an existing pattern of behaviour. You walk into that area and there's newspaper all over the floor, so they're eating from the newspaper, playing on the newspaper, sleeping on the newspaper, and defecating and peeing on the newspaper. No discrimination occurs. Border collie born on a farm, raised in the barn, you try and house train that. Hardest breed to house train in the UK, probably in the USA as well, is the Bichon Frise. Breeders keep them on white paper because their coat is very absorbent and stains easily. They keep them on white paper. So we've done that test. Next, there has to be loads of toys there. All puppies at 3 weeks of age almost start to play. And if there are no toys, they'll play physical games with one another. I could tell you every breed and the games that it plays. So two boxers, so boxer puppies. So we got mum here, and she's teaching her puppies to play, and they practice with one another. So she'll encourage them, she'll wag her tail, and turn to run, and then stop. Look, usually over her right shoulder, three quarters on, and when the puppy comes over, she'll put, so the puppy bounces over, she'll put her right front paw between the puppy's front paws, and then rise up like that, and in one movement has flipped it onto its back, and she's got her teeth playfully around the puppy's throat. And that is how, if you get a puppy, a boxer puppy, raised in a litter of boxer puppies, kept too long at the breeders, that's exactly how, if it ever fights with other dogs, that's exactly how it will do it. Corgis do it differently, don't they? So in other words, they'll play. They'll play with one another. If there are toys in the litter, which change every 2 or 3 days, they're more directed to playing with the toy. They'll play with one another with the toy. One puppy will pick the toy up and they'll play. Instead of using one another's ears, they'll actually use the toy. It's like a miracle occurs. You take that puppy 6 or 7 weeks of age from that litter that have been raised with toys, and you take any toy, the puppy will play with you with the toy. And you won't ever have to correct it for biting your fingers. In that, it's like a revelation. So, and we call it play biting, don't we? Of course, in the USA, it's common for owners to give the puppies toys. In Scotland, it's and a lot of around European countries, it's more common for owners to play with their puppies with toys. So it's why, you know, in different cultures, the solution, so how do I stop my puppy biting my kid's fingers? Well, there's this crazy idea, we shout, ouch. Do that with a terrier, heightens the level of arousal, doesn't it? Okay? The breeder should have got that right to begin with. If the breeders get it right, you shouldn't have to do anything like that. So I just want you to think about that concept. Usually puppies raised in someone's house, probably, I don't know, in the 20s, 30s, 40s, there's plenty of things for them to play with in that litter, and they played with things with one another. We've stopped doing that now. Next thing that we look at, so we've seen all that. We're now going to ask the breeder to feed the puppies. Here's a good one. There's six puppies, there should be 9 bowls of food put down. If there's 6 puppies and they put 1 bowl of food down, you've now created competition over a resource. And that's where food aggression comes from. If you have a dog that's a bit food aggressive, look to the breeder. I know exactly how they fed them. So 6 Labrador puppies, we feed them out of 1 bowl, enough for 6 Labrador puppies. And one will eat a mouthful more than it's supposed to have, which means one goes without. It's usually the thinnest ones in the litter that are become the most food aggressive. If they don't fight for it, they don't get it. It doesn't mean there's going to be like a pitched battle and blood everywhere, but what happens is the puppies learn to eat faster. It's a test we do in a puppy class. You put a bowl of food down, release the puppy, and when the puppy's eating, ask the owner to walk towards it. If it eats faster, it tells me that the puppy does not trust the owner. And whatever they do now, they're almost doomed to make the behavior worse. Hey, don't eat it that quickly. So they take it away. And now we get there. So we call that stage 1 food aggression. So we then get stage 2, watch me carefully. So you go near the puppy when he's eating, he puts his head over the bowl and does this, watch carefully. Oh, did he growl? I didn't hear him growl. Okay. Hey, don't do that. And then we get the growl and the air snap. No intent. And actually, at that point, most owners learn, leave him alone when he's eating. It shouldn't ever happen. I want a puppy to trust me. And I could give you the complete cure for any food aggression problem if we have time, but we're running out. But the breeder, if the breeder gets that bit right, so we go on and on and on. Now, before I take the puppy home, I'm going to say the same, by the way. How many people here are connected to shelters? I'm guessing quite a few of you. Okay. I had to be careful. You do a great job under incredibly difficult... I couldn't do the job that you guys do. But anyway, so I'm often asked, you know, how do I select a dog from a shelter? Well, it's the same as getting a puppy, isn't it? It's exactly the same as getting a puppy. And it's not a shelter dog, it's just a second-hand dog, like a pre-owned dog, that's all. Same as your car, it's just pre-owned, isn't it? So don't feel sorry for it. Anyone, when they bought a pre-owned car, anyone feel sorry for it? Don't feel sorry for the puppy. It's just a new start in life. Okay, so the last thing that we ask the breeder to do, before we decide to take a puppy, if it's a puppy, pick it up, put it on a table or something. In other words, lift it up, and I want to see you groom it for 20 minutes. Actually, breeders of long-coated breeds are often able to do that because they like to keep the coat in good condition. It's the short-coated ones that are the hardest usually for people to handle. Why? Because the breeders never ever taught the puppy to be restrained and handled. So if the breeder is trying to groom the puppy all over for 20 minutes with an appropriate brush, and what you're seeing is a temper tantrum, I would not buy that puppy. Because you're going to have to fix a problem on a puppy that you've just purchased. And you can fix it, but why would you want to? That's like buying a pre-owned car, isn't it? And you've got to now start fixing problems with it. Exactly the same at shelters, by the way. You know, to select a dog from a shelter, you're going to do a series of tests. And one of the tests is mix up a bowl of food, put it down, I want to see a member of staff go and stroke the dog. If they can't, I don't want the dog. Remember, you can train a dog to accept being touched when it's eating. That's just a simple behavior modification program. And I'm also going to ask the member of shelter staff to groom the dog for 20 minutes. Again, if they can't do it, how do they expect me to do it? You know, they're professional, they're doing it full time. I'm not a professional. Just want you to think about selecting a puppy. Now we're going to take it home. Okay, and we look at patterns of behavior. I won't do this because some of you did this with me at the weekend. Okay, pattern of behavior. All behavior that we look at in dogs and in people exists in patterns. So if the owner says to me, it was unpredictable, he suddenly did this, it's out of character for the way he normally behaves. Okay, so unpredictable, out of character, it's just a suddenly occurred. The dog needs to see a veterinarian, not a dog trainer or a behaviorist. What we look for is a pattern. If there isn't a pattern, certainly I wouldn't be able to help you with the problem. So it's always a pattern that we look for. And when you get the puppy, if you have to look at a pattern of behavior. So the example is, I'm going to say to the breeder, what time do you go to bed at night? What time did the family go to bed at night? Switch all the lights out and sleep. That will be a pattern of behavior, won't it? So if the breeder says 11 o'clock, so 11 o'clock at night is when we all go to bed, switch the lights out, the puppy expects to sleep at 11 o'clock. If my family go to bed at 10 o'clock, what do you think will happen for an hour? See, patterns of behavior. The trick is to keep to a pattern of behavior for the first few days and then make it, change it to your pattern of behavior. So that's one pattern of behavior. I'm also going to say to the breeder, what time do you feed the puppies? It should be exactly the same time each day. Usually they're fed four times a day. And I can then say to the breeder, what time do the puppies eliminate? So there should be some correlation between eating and elimination. So, and if I know that, it is incredibly simple to housebreak a puppy. I say, we wouldn't ever put them in a crate to do that. We'd provide them with a surface, and at the various danger times, we'd be observing the puppy. The easiest way to do it, putting an umbilical cord on, a little cord that attaches to the puppy's collar, attach that to you, and then you can watch him all the time. So it's incredibly simple to do. You're just continuing a pattern of behavior that mother has started. We've now also got the separation problem. So I bring my puppy home. If I get it right, and he's tired when the family go to sleep, he will sleep. I've never, ever had a problem with a puppy howling, barking, crying. And typically in the UK, we put our dogs in the kitchen when we go to bed at night. So we usually go upstairs to bed. The puppy's in the kitchen. I've never, ever had a problem with a puppy being distressed, barking, because of the pattern of behavior. If you buy a puppy from a litter where from 3 weeks of age onwards, mother was allowed at will to move away from the puppies where they couldn't follow and get back to where the puppies were at will, she's already taught them something called enforced separation. In other words, don't be distressed, I'll come back later. So they become more confident when they're separated from their attachment figure. More confident. And that's when you see them play more with one another. So, and she's doing that deliberately. When they're 3 hours old, you can't drag her away from them. When they're usually 6 or 7 weeks of age, she's actually writing the advertisement out herself. She doesn't want, and so she transitions them from being all caring, completely devoted to her, to being more independent. If they're kept in an environment where she can't escape, she cannot escape from them, you take one of those puppies home. Straight away when you get it home, it will suffer from something called separation anxiety. That's where it comes from. Most of it comes from a breeder. The ones that don't come from a breeder come from rescue. Perhaps I should do that as well, as we've got a lot of people from rescue. Okay, I'm going to go to rescue and choose a dog. So you see how I'm going to, because I couldn't own a dog that suffered from separation anxiety. Nobody in the whole of India actually has a dog that suffers from separation anxiety. Did you know that? It doesn't exist in India. It's a cultural thing. So when I get a puppy from rescue, so watch how I do it very quickly. Very quickly. So we got puppies or dogs in each of the kennels. We'll do it an adult dog. So I come to one of the dogs and I look at it and the dog goes, whoa! Well, that's how it will behave when a stranger comes to my house. So I don't want that one. It might be great if you want a watchdog, guard dog, but I don't want that one. I go to the next one, look at it, and I'm going to talk to it. Watch. So I'm going to smile, talk to it. I'm going to do that. Hello, what's your name? And the dog looks at me, smiles, looks at the door, looks at me, wags his tail, looks at the door. He didn't like me. He just sees me as a key to the door. I open the door, he'd be gone. Volunteers teach dogs that behavior, don't they? Okay. So I wouldn't want a dog like that. I want a dog that actually wants me. I go to the next kennel and I look at the dog and he's lying in the back of the kennel and he sort of, hello, what's your name? And he goes, oh. And then you see the little tear appear in his eye. Oh, I feel sorry for him. Oh, he looks, and even better if the staff tell me, no, he has a bad background. He was left abandoned on the railings by the side of the shelter. Okay, and that now tugs at my heartstrings. And that's the very dog I shouldn't take home. Don't ever take a dog from a shelter because you feel sorry for it. Quickly answer me the question. The partner that you're with at the moment, when you first met them, are you with them as a partner just because you felt sorry for them? Don't answer it. It's the worst start to a relationship. And then what we get is the owner, and this is what they say to me, he's a rescue dog. The dog doesn't know he's a rescue dog. Okay, he's just been pre-owned. And they'll tell me, and when we got him, Mr. Rogerson, he's very thin. For that, read correct weight. You see the dog And he had diarrhea when we first, well, it's because of all the stuff you started feeding because you thought he was very thin. And I got him on a Friday evening so I could spend all weekend with him. And I overcompensated from the life I thought he had. So I fed him all the best food. I doted on him. I talked to him all the time. And then on Monday, when I had to leave the house for about maybe an hour, I started to show signs of separation anxiety. Oh, I've got to go out in a minute. Oh, no, I'm sorry, I can't take it. Be a good boy. I've got to go upstairs and get rid. I'm sorry. This is the pacing behavior. Okay. Upstairs, come down. Caress him again, beg him to be good, tell him he won't be long, I promise I'll be back, get to the door, blow him a kiss. Go out. And by the time you go out, the dog's going, oh, I can't cope. And some of them start to chew, some of them start to bark. So I'll give you a miracle cure, but it won't work for any of your dogs. It will only work if you can convince an owner of a dog it will work. It's a strange thing because you can't separate the dog's behavior from the behavior of an owner. You can't do that. They're inseparable. So if you buy something or you tell the owner, buy something, it's called a dog appeasing pheromone diffuser. It's this French device. You plug it into an outlet and the thing just, it's a little diffuser and it releases relaxing pheromones. See? So you plug it in about 20 minutes before you go out and then the puppy relaxes. Oh, I'm relaxed now. Then you can just simply go out the house and the dog will be fine. All you need to do is convince the owner it will work. And it will change their behavior. Okay? So, oh, don't worry, you'll be fine, I'll plug this in. Seriously. I'll let you into a not very well known secret. I've actually done it with Glade air fresheners. So, what I'm trying to explain, you can't separate the dog's behavior from the owner's behavior. So we've got our puppy, we've taken it from the breeder, we're getting into pattern of behavior, and again, a lot depends on the breed of dog that I've got. So now, here's the first problem. So it's now started to bond to me, and this is a question we always ask owners when they come to us with a problem dog. First question we ask, so we've got two owners sat there, husband, wife, perhaps a child, they're sat in front of us, and the first question, so whose dog is it? What's the correct answer? What do you think often the answer is? It's my husband's dog. It's my wife's dog. That's the first mistake. That tells me there's going to be a problem. Actually, I very rarely see anyone with a dog behavior problem where they describe the dog as our dog. It's my wife's dog. It's my husband's dog. We got it for our daughter. Okay? If you want a family dog, it had to be a family decision. It has to be owned by the family. So that's the first mistake. So I've got this puppy now, and the first thing we look at, again, a little bit relative to breed, what we have to look at is how anyone in your family comes into the house. So in your family, your partner, perhaps your children, when they come into the house, how do they get into the house? How do they get in? How do they get through the door? Key and turn it, okay? So I've got a, let's do hover vault, in case you think I'm picking on breeds. So it's, some breeds have been bred to be very territorial, okay? So we've accepted when anyone in the family comes in, they put a key in the lock and turn it, and then walk in. So the dog hears that as a signal. And then we get this excitement, don't we? Oh, hello. Okay, we do all this. I'll very quickly show you how to stop the dog jumping up later on when you come in out of excitement. Okay, so we have family when they come in, they'll walk in, and they'll walk in by making a sound, key in the lock, come in. How does anyone who's not in your family come in through the door? They have to knock on it. So with some breeds, straight away, that's now a discriminatory signal. In other words, you're the one who taught the territorial behavior. You taught the puppy there's a difference between friends and family and strangers. Because how's a dog? If I'm a human being and you're a human being, why is my dog worried about you and not me? It's because the owners have taught that. Okay, worse than that, I've now got my puppy here, he's bonded to me, and I'm starting to become a role model for his behavior. So he'll watch me an awful lot. A role model for behavior, he'll take a lot of his behaviors from me. how I behave. So watch this. This is your moment, Mia. It's Mia's big moment. So let's just imagine, she's not, but just imagine that Mia's my partner, she's my assistant. When she comes in, key in the lock, turns and she comes in, my puppy's here watching, watch this. Okay, my puppy's here watching this. Are you supposed to be happy, pleased to see me? Hi, how you doing? Okay, the puppy's seen that. Now watch when someone who I don't know comes to the door and I invite them in, watch what I do. Hi, how you doing? It's different, isn't it? I've behaved differently. If I've got a German Shepherd, now let's pick a different breed. If I've got a Rhodesian Ridgeback, I've now actually taught the dog to go to someone, make contact and back away. Okay, I've just taught that, haven't I? It's called an allelomimetic behavior. In other words, the dog's copying, mimicking my behavior. So you see, come up, touched and backed away, that's exactly what your puppy's going to start doing. In fact, what you're going to get in no time at all is when someone comes up, the dog will run up woo, and back away. It's exactly what you taught it to do. So I want you to think about this. Anyone have a problem, you know, with a dog with a mailman? We have a bigger problem in the UK, because the mailman actually pushes something through into our house.
Yeah.
Sorry?
We don't have mail.
Oh, cool. Oh, so you don't have the problem. Oh.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, okay. But to solve the problem, when next time you get a puppy, have an affair with a FedEx man, I bet the puppy is fine. It's your behavior. It's the contact and back away that creates the problem. Okay, so we've got, let's do a quick behavior problem. I'll give you solutions, hopefully, because behavior problems are simple if you look at the owner first. If you look at the dog first, it becomes complicated. So we look at the owner. So I have an owner who phones me. She says, I've got a Jack Russell Terrier. This is in the UK. I've got a Jack Russell Terrier. When the mailman comes in the morning, deliver the mail into the house through a little letterbox. When the mailman comes, the dog sleeps in the bedroom with me. That's fairly common in the UK. The dog actually slept in the bed with her, not on the bed, in the bed with her. And she said, when he hears the mailman come, he leaps out of bed, gets to the bedroom door, and he's scratching the door. So I have to get out of bed, and I get hold of him by the collar. And sometimes he manages to twist around and get free. And when I open the door, if he manages to get free, he races downstairs and he grabs the mail and he'll run past me to the top of the stairs. And if I go near him, he'll rip them to pieces and he'll growl and he would bite. Jack Russell Terrier. And I asked her to repeat that. She said, well, when the mail, so the whole thing again, mailman comes, the dog runs downstairs. If he manages to get free, you know, he wriggles away, gets downstairs, twists around, grabs letters, runs at the top of the stairs, tears them apart. And if I go near him, he gets really aggressive and probably, well, he would bite me. Okay, I said, that's an amazing coincidence. Not 10 minutes ago, I had a Jack Russell Terrier on the phone to me. And he said he had a problem with his owner. I said, what's the problem? And he said, every morning when the mailman comes, she gets really excited and races me to the door. Sometimes I manage to hold her back, but sometimes she wriggles free. And if she gets downstairs first, she picks up as many as she can carry, takes them into the kitchen and rips them apart and gets really aggressive if I want one. It is exactly the same behavior. Honestly, a lot of the behavior problems that I see, it's the same behavior. The dog, so, you know, some people have seen this. The owner comes and says, how can I stop my dog pulling on the lead? And I look at the dog and the dog says, how can I stop my owner pulling on the lead? Because it can't, unless you pull, can it? It can't do that. So you want to think about that. Separation anxiety, it's a human condition that we then put on the dog. Dog-to-dog aggression. If you understand the behavior of young dogs, you can solve most dog-to-dog aggression problems really quickly and simply. Okay, let's go through a few behavior problems. I can't believe that's the time already. 6 o'clock, goodness. Let's go through some quick behavior problems. Let's do separation problems, because they're really easy, okay? So my dog doesn't like being left by itself. How does it know it's left by itself? So we have an owner. There's various types of separation problems. Say separation anxiety, that's one of the more difficult ones to solve, because the owner's have actually got the problem themselves. They feel guilty about leaving the dog by itself. They're worried about leaving it by itself. If you're not worried about leaving it by itself, the dog won't be worried about you leaving it. Okay, so separation problems, because I know people have problems with that. And so we see that the symptoms of a separation problem might be that the dog barks. It might be that it chews things up. Again, in the UK, we would never, if a dog is destructive when it's left, we would never ever advise the use of a crate. Never under any circumstances advise the use of a crate. So if it's destroying things because it's attention seeking or it's under stress and you put it in a crate and it now can't chew anything, what do you think will happen? It'll either start chewing itself if it's under stress, or as an attention seeker, now it can't chew things up to gain attention, it will start barking. You see, in the UK, if your dog rips up your house when you leave it, only affects you, doesn't it? If it barks when you leave it, it now affects your neighbours. That's a serious complaint. So we would never advise the use of a crate to solve a separation problem under any circumstances. I would want to fix the problem. And they're easy to fix. So what we look at with separation problems, why is the dog doing it? You know, why is the dog chewing things up when you leave it? Separation anxiety is not that common in the UK. I say it's unheard of in India. It's probably a fairly common one in certain communities in the USA, more likely to happen in a big city than it is out in the country. Okay, so we look at the symptoms. So if your dog is destructive when left or it barks, it would be a very similar sort of problem. If it's separation anxiety, it means that the dog is stressed to the point of distress. So it can't cope at being alone by itself in the house. It can't cope with that. The symptoms are, you start to see signs even before you leave. When you come back, check the water bowl. There'll be splashes all around the water bowl because the dog under stress will drink more. And because it drinks more, it will pee more, and it might defecate. Poop might defecate a lot more, and the poop will be very loose. So that will be the symptoms of the dog being stressed or overly stressed. When you return home, the dog remains stressed and very clingy for some time afterwards. For separation anxiety, because lots of people think if my dog can't be by itself, it must suffer from separation anxiety. Not many do. The definition of separation anxiety, the dog becomes highly stressed and distressed when separated from its attachment figure. That's the definition. So if your dog sleeps downstairs at night when you go to bed with the door closed, your dog cannot possibly suffer from separation anxiety, can it? It has to sleep or it has to have access to you 24 hours a day, and it's only when it's physically denied that access and visually denied the access and it becomes distressed that we refer to it as separation anxiety. Okay, so that's the definition. Most dogs that I see, it's not that they suffer from something called attention seeking destruction. It's an attention seeking behavior, which is a repetitive behavior. Okay, and I'll quickly show you how to teach it. Actually, I don't need to, because most dog books will tell you how to teach a dog to suffer from attention-seeking destruction or attention-seeking barking. Okay, they'll do that. Almost any book. So, I've got a puppy, and I give him toys to play with. That's the first big mistake. I should play with him with toys. Two types of toys a puppy should have. One we call interactive. So when those toys are on the floor, if he wants to play, I'm going to play with him. If I pick a toy up, he should play with me. Same as you do with kids, interactive toys. We've also got, so interactive toys would be a game of checkers, wouldn't it? Something like that. Do you remember kids used to play that with their parents? That's an interactive game. So if the puppy says, "Will you play?" and those toys are on the floor, I'll respond. So if my kids say, "You know, Dad, will you play a game of checkers?" Yes, I will. On the other hand, if I want to play with the puppy and I invite the game, again, I expect the puppy to play with me. So that's called interactive. But puppies should have a second set of toys that we can give them when we don't want to be bothered by them. So if you give a wire-haired fox terrier a squeaky toy, well, it will bother you with the squeaking, but it won't bother you physically, will it? It'll just take it away and go and kill it somewhere quietly. So that is a non-interactive toy. We've never ever developed any breed of terrier to kill the rat and bring it to us. So they like to take it away somewhere and kill it. Okay, well, that's genetic, isn't it? That's exactly what we want them to do. We have breeds like the Manchester Terrier, designed to eradicate rats from Manchester. Another failed breed. We still have rats in Manchester. Useless breed. Okay, so We've got this puppy, and we didn't understand about interactive toys, isolation toys. So now I've got these toys lying on the floor. The puppy picks one up and says, "Dad, will you play?" "No, I'm busy. I'm watching football on the television." Soccer in the UK. That's the translation. So the puppy now is inviting a game, and I reject it. And then, because it's getting a bit bored, this little border collie, working breeds are the worst for this, it will then go and put its teeth on the wooden leg of the coffee table. And remarkably, I then turn away from the ball game. "Oh, don't do that. No, don't touch that. Look, here's a toy, play with that. Can you see what I've just done?" I've actually said to him, "If I don't want to play with you, if you chew the coffee table, I will play with you with a toy." Okay, what a lot of people, I'll give you the secrets, what a lot of people don't know about this. In dog training, dog behavior, we have something called an association time. People learned that over the last 3 days. Association time, if you want the dog to learn something really quickly, the association between a command and a behavior has to be less than half a second. And everyone saw at the weekend when we did that, how amazingly quickly the dogs are able to learn things. But what a lot of people don't understand, there's something called a disassociation time. If I do not want the dog to associate that event with playing with a toy, we use a disassociation time of 2 minutes or greater. Okay, so quickly, I'm going to give you a miracle cure. When anyone comes through your door, the dog jumps up at them. And it jumps up in excitement. Why does it do that? Because we taught it to. It's the only reason it does it. Because someone's taught it to. When it's a puppy, we get down on hands and knees. Then when we stand up, it's trying to raise itself to our height. Of course they jump up. The dog will only do what you allow it to do and what you teach it to do. Okay, so I've now got this puppy. When anyone comes in, he starts to jump up. And what are we told by behaviorists? We're told, ignore him until all 4 feet are on the floor. That's that. Okay. If you've ever heard that advice, you know it doesn't work, don't you? All around the world, no one's ever actually had any knowledge that's ever worked. But people keep repeating it all the time. Because someone writes it in a book, it must be right, mustn't it? I'll give you something that will work. This is attention. It's attention seeking. Why won't ignoring it work? So when you first come in, you just have to ignore it until all 4 feet are on the floor. Two reasons. First of all, this is an owner ignoring their dog. So it comes in, the dog jumps up, and they go. Actually, I wouldn't say that was ignoring the dog, would you? I would say that's giving it 100% attention. Okay. The second reason that won't work is. My behaviorist, my trainer, didn't tell me I had to ignore it for at least 2 minutes. Because behaviors that result in attention seeking, all these attention seeking behaviors, they actually rotate in about a 2 minute interval. So let's see if I can give you the example. I walk in, the dogs jump up, jump up, jump up. Oh, my legs are getting a bit achy. Hold on a second. Jump up, jump up, jump up. Hold on a sec. Jump up. That's a pattern of behavior. And if all 4 feet are on the floor and he's still thinking, oh, I'm just about to jump again, and you say, good boy, I've still rewarded the jumping up behavior. I have to make sure 2 minutes have elapsed. You see how we stop a dog barking by using 2 minutes. Okay, so this is the cure. Try it. Contact Lindsay if it doesn't work. Okay, when anyone comes into the house, and you have to write this on the door, but do it yourself to begin with. When anyone comes through that door, you write this up, you have to approach the nearest window, so ignore the dog. So you come into the house, doesn't matter what the dog's doing, and look out the window, and out loud describe everything that you can see out the window. So I can see the snow-covered hills in the background there, and actually there's lights on the ski slope. Out loud. First thing that will happen, I've changed your behavior. First thing that will happen is the dog will go, what are you looking at? After two, okay, by looking out the window and describing everything out loud, you actually will ignore the dog. And after 2 minutes, just turn around and say, oh, hi there, and just carry on, what were you doing? And you should find within 3 days all the jumping up stops. We're the ones who teach it. It's our behavior that sets that pattern, giving attention. Okay, back to our puppy that was chewing things. Remember, hey, don't do that. Here, look, you play with this. That's for you. So we've now got the puppy trained. Attention seeking, putting his teeth on the wooden coffee table leg. Curtains always work really well, or blinds, don't they? And it's always a potted plant, isn't it? Because I guarantee if you've got a big potted plant, puppy height, it will grab the leaf and you'll immediately pay attention to it. Okay, now depending on the breed, Labrador 8 months of age, Border Collie 6 months of age, German Shepherd about 9-10 months of age. I'll give you the age of every breed that they're going to do this. This is an experimental phase. So now this dog is based on patterns of behaviour. We're now going to go out for a while, and so he doesn't destroy anything, I'm going to leave toys on the floor. That's the mistake. I put the toys down. These are interactive toys. These are the ones that we use to play with one another. So I put interactive toys down and then I leave. And the dog looks at the toys, looks, oh, well, I thought we were going to have a game. That's the car driving off, I think. Yep, that's definitely the car. Hold on a second. Yep, they've gone. How do I get them to come back and play with those toys? I know. So if you watch the puppy do it, watch this young dog do it, he'll do it, choo, 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 typically, same pattern, just a couple of minutes, then it will stop, listen, no, I'm not coming back, hold on, dick, yeah. Stop, listen, can't see them, can't hear them, oh, that hasn't worked, oh, the curtains, put the curtains down, no, 3 to 5 minutes, cushions usually bring... I know the potted plant will get them to come back. So there's always soil on the floor. And then sooner or later, he's engaging, and this is mass destruction, it's not one thing that he chews. So sooner or later, he's chewing something, chew, 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 chew. That sounds like the car. Sorry, it doesn't sound like the car, that sounds like the way my owners drive a car. How many cars of yours are on the road? It's not your car, the dog understands, it's your pattern of driving behavior. Yeah, that looks like the car. It's worked. Yee-hoo! And the owner then walks in and they go, oh, hey, who's done this? And the dog says, well, it's me, that's why you've come in. What's the only thing the dog hasn't touched? The toys. And within 2 minutes of you arriving home, the dog's now picking the toy up saying, come on, do you want to play? It's exactly what you trained it to do. Just keep remembering, we cannot separate the behavior of a dog from the behavior of its owner. They only ever do either what you teach them to do or what you allow them to do. So what's the cure? This is attention seeking destruction. We have to change the owner's behavior. Some of you will look confused when I start talking about this, so you need to think about it. Okay. Change the owner's behavior. So that's all you need to do. You take, I know we recommend a cheese stuffed marrow bone, you know, anything like that. You can't use a Kong toy because you need to be able to hear when the dog's chewing. So cheese stuffed marrow bone, you have the hollow marrow bone, stuff some cheese or liver pate in, and just put the dog in a room by itself. So we put the dog in that room. Don't show it the bone, just put it somewhere you know the dog will find it and close the door. So the dog's now in that room. If he has any kind of a nose at all, he'll find a cheese or liver pate stuffed bone and sit against the door so he can smell the other side of the door and put your ear against the door. And as soon as you hear him chewing that bone, this will confuse some of you initially. As soon as you hear him chewing that bone, I want you to quickly open the door, go in there, and say to him, hey, who's done this? Take the bone off him, wrap it in saran wrap and put it in the refrigerator. That's exactly how you trained to chew everything else, wasn't it? You know, you paid attention to it. So as soon as you hear him chew it, immediately go in. Take it off him, okay? Give him a lot of attention. And then put two in there. Put two where you know he'll find, but don't give them to him. So if you put two in there, listen. Hear him chew one, don't go in there. What he'll do is he'll chew it, and say, are you coming in yet? No, I'll try the other one, chew, chew, chew. So as soon as you hear him chewing a second bone, immediately go in. In no time at all, it takes less than, well, with most dogs, it takes less than 4 days of training. When you go out, just put several bones down, stuff in different places. Don't put them under a cushion, because he might chew the cushion to get to them. Put them in different locations. We video dogs doing this. The dog will rotate from bone to bone to bone, stopping after 3 to 5 minutes, checking, and sooner or later it'll be correct, won't it? Sooner or later, that will bring you back in. We can also, if we want to, I mean, normally you don't need to, you can also add a penalty. So you could take things that he would normally chew in your absence, and you can leave them in there and put, I'd normally recommend something like, I don't know, an empty soda can with a couple of little stones in it. That's not to correct the dog, by the way. But if you stand on something he's likely to chew, you'll actually hear if he disturbs it. And with your ear against the door.
If you hear one of these move, okay, step by step, move ear away from door.
And strike door with palm of hand without saying anything. So when you choose something he's not supposed to have, the door keeps going bang. If you choose the bone, you go in. Have I changed the dog's behaviour? No, I've only changed the owner's behaviour. I've only changed what you pay attention to. And it works like a miracle. So I just want you to think about it. Now let's do attention-seeking barking. Yep.
If you're to address a dog's behaviour by addressing the owner's behaviour, yep. What do you do in the face of a shelter dog that goes into a new home expressing yep. certain behaviour?
Yep. You first of all, by behaviour testing the dog, you address the previous owner's behaviour. That dog, all of its behaviour will be based on its former life. And
if you don't know that?
You do know that. You do know that. Yeah, you'll always know. Okay, let me give you the example. You'll always know that. If the staff understand dog behaviour, you know everything about that dog. So I'll give you some ideas. We actually do this with shelter dogs on some of the things that we do. So first of all is just looking at the dog. As long as it's just come in, it's come in recently, within the last, we're going to say 48 hours. And see if you can do it the same as me. So if you look at the dog's hind feet, and you look at the nails on its hind feet, and they're very short and rounded. So the dog's nails are rounded and they're very short, and but the front ones are normal size. What does that tell you about how the dog's been kept? He obviously spent a lot of time jumping up, looking over a fence or something, hasn't he? It's the only way that can happen, physically. How about it comes in, all the nails are really long. So he hasn't been taken out for lots of exercise, certainly hasn't been outside in the backyard running around digging, has he? Back nails, normal length, front nails very short and rounded. He's a digger, isn't he? And we haven't even started behaviour testing yet. You can know a huge amount about a dog. Will the dog catch a food treat? If it catches a food treat, what will that tell you? Probably been kids in the house. Very rare you'll find an elderly person who's owned a dog that will catch a food treat. Kids train it in no time at all. They walk past the dog with a bit of food in the hand, the dog or the puppy jumps up and they go, oh, and it catches a food treat. And if it doesn't, the kid will quickly pick the food treat off the ground. I don't mean dog food treats, I mean what they're eating. So you can tell, play a game with a toy. Dogs that have played interactive games with their owners with toys will play at the shelter within 48 hours. And look at the way that the dog plays. So I'll give you an example. Does the dog like to play games of tug? You always do this with the dog on the lead. If it plays a game of tug, what happens? So you've got it on the lead. What happens when you let go of the tug toy? If it turns away and tries to go away, I'm going to say the dog is possessive. We didn't say aggressive, but it's possessive, isn't it? It doesn't want you to have the toy. If, on the other hand, I'm playing tug and I let go of the toy, the dog looks at me and drops it to the floor, that's better, because the dog's saying, it's only fun if you're playing with me. What I really want is when I let go of the toy, the dog pushes it back at me and says, I want you to play with me, please. That will tell you a massive amount about the previous owner. Just ask a question to people who work at shelter. When people come to your shelter and they do select a dog, how do they get it home? How do they actually get it home, physically? Are they going in a car? No one walks it home. They get in a car. So I'm sure you test the dogs, don't you, for being in a car? Okay, start of a relationship. I've got a dog that has been dumped out of a car. In fact, when I got it as a puppy, the only time it went in the car was to the veterinarians to get jabs. It's been kept in my backyard all the time. The second time I put it in the car, I took it to the shelter. So I'm now going to get that dog and put it in my car. That's a good start to a relationship, isn't it? Because bad things happen with people when you go in a car. All the dogs should be tested. Look at patterns of behaviour. So, I just want you to think about this. If you walk the dog towards the car and it's sort of turning its head away and it's going a bit green and you see these drools, what does it tell you about the dog? Travel sick. Before you even get it in the car. That's a bad start to a relationship. I don't know if you ever thought about this. So when you open the car door, you don't have to say anything. When you open the car door, does the dog jump in, wagging its tail? If it does, what does it tell you about the previous owner? So you can do the same as me. It's just loads of people that work at shelters, they don't ever look at the dogs. They don't ever think that the dog actually will tell them everything they want to know about its past, if you know how to ask it. So you want to think about this carefully. So I was actually involved in the first time in British legal history. There was a death took place down near the south coast. So someone was found dead. The police had some suspicions. And the only witness to the death was a dog. Only thing that witnessed the death. So I was asked to go down there and interview the dog. I know this, it sounds bizarre, doesn't it? But it's just behavior testing. I was asked to go down and interview the dog. I went down there after 2 hours of interviewing the dog. First time in British legal history, the police immediately go and arrest someone and charge him with murder. Because dogs don't tell lies. Your dog's pattern of behavior won't change. So you could tell the length of, if the dog's been tethered somewhere, you can tell the length of tether it's been on, you can tell if it's been tethered, can't you? You know how to test that? Okay, so you get just a little length of rope or line, and you hold the dog on it, and then gently wrap it once around the dog's hind leg, and just hold on. If it panics, it's never been tethered. If it flicks its back leg, it obviously has. It knows how to release itself, doesn't it? From a tangle. So see, you can do the same as me. There's nothing magic about it. Dog behavior is really simple. Loads of people don't actually look at the dogs. What they're looking at with their heart and nothing more. Okay, dogs that bark. Okay, that's called an alert bark. And I did that because you frightened me. And see, when I did it, I moved backwards and some of you moved backwards as well fairly quickly. Okay, so that's called an alert bark, isn't it? It tells me that I startle the dog. And dogs that do that are asking for two things. They're asking for distance and time to make an assessment of the situation. And every dog that does that, if you give them those two things, you'll never ever get bitten. So I used to love working with Rottweilers. A Rottweiler will usually tell you a week before it's going to bite you if you listen to it. Japanese Akitas don't. They're raised in a different culture where and the Japanese try to disguise their emotions in public. They never actually show emotion, and the dogs, Shiba Inu, Akita Inu, exactly the same. So again, look at the type of dog that you've got. So that's one type of bark. We do the attention seeking bark. It's a pattern. So you see the dog in the back of a car and it's looking at the owner and it's wagging its tail and it will go woof 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 woof. And it keeps repeating. What it's trying to say is, excuse me, I can see you there, you got your back to me. Have you noticed I'm talking to you? Turn round and talk to me, please. Quiet. Immediately reward the dog for that behaviour. Thank you. And you sometimes, in the UK, if we have like a street of houses, all with gardens, and a few of them have dogs, so we got dog at number 43 and a dog at number 19. And the owners have gone out and left the dogs. The dog at number 43 does that bark. Woof, 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 woof. Is there anyone out? I'm all by myself in number 43. Woof, 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 woof. I'm in 19, I'm alone as well. Goes backwards and forwards. The dog in the car behind you, you know, first time you're going to drive him somewhere and you get that bark. It's attention seeking. The dog will bark, same pattern, then turn around, wag its tail, look at you again, bark. And again, all it's saying is, why have you got your back of your head to me? You don't do this in the house. I'm always in the position where I can see you. Why are you sitting with your, please turn around, say something, will you be quiet? Thank you. Woof, 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 woof. Okay. Most dogs learn everything that they need for life by a system called trial and error. It's called trial and error learning. And I'll give you an example of that. So first time I put a puppy in a room by itself, and okay, for anyone who is really technically minded, what I'm going to say is absolute rubbish. But I want you to understand it from the dog's point of view, so I'm afraid sometimes I can do this scientifically, but then no one understands it anyway. Okay, so I'm going to look at from a human perspective as though the puppy is a human. So I put the puppy in the room by itself. So we're going to talk about attention-seeking bark and when you put the puppy in a room by itself. So I put him in a room by itself and close the door. And the puppy, being a social animal, doesn't want to be by itself. It wants to be with me. part of its family, hopefully not part of its pack. I hope it's part of its family group it wants to be with, which is slightly different, isn't it? So I don't want to be a pack leader for my dog. I want to be part of my dog's family. Just a different way of looking at it. Nothing right, nothing wrong, just opinions. So I put him in there by himself, and now look at the problem he has. He wants to be with me, but he can't get to me because the door's in the way, that big piece of wood. And clearly it does open, because you see me open it, put him in, isn't he? I don't understand the mechanism by which this door comes open. And so he'll try, and this is trial and error. The greater his desire to be with me, the more things he'll try. Just called trial and error learning. First thing he tries, barking at the door. Open sesame. So he's barking, and it'll be that pan. Woof, 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 woof. What he's saying is, please, door, will you come open? Door, I know you open. Please, will you come open? Are you listening to me, door? Be quiet. Ah, it comes open. I've found the mechanism by which, and for the rest of his life, every time you put him in a room or anywhere by himself, and he wants to be with you, that's the behavior you're going to get. But of course, the behaviorist will say to you, ignore him. Only go in when you're quiet. Keep remembering that pattern. Woof, 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 woof. Woof, 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 woof. Almost the same pattern, the same phrase, keeps repeating. Woof, woof. 3 to 5 minutes, then he'll stop. He'll stop to check to see if it's having any effect. He'll stop by sniffing the bottom of the door, listening carefully, and wait to see if it's had an effect. It hasn't. Woof, and he'll start it again. And if I've been told to go in only when he's quiet, he is quiet, but he's still in that pattern, that mental pattern of behavior. So if I go in there, I've still rewarded that behavior. That's why we have to say, if he's barking for attention, you mustn't respond to that attention until he's been quiet for at least 2 minutes. And then when you go in, he will only associate the fact that he's quiet with you coming in and not the barking. That sounds great, doesn't it? That will work. But I don't know any owner who would do that. So you're going to sit and you have to wait for 2 minutes. It might take an hour before it stops for 2 minutes. I don't know any owner who'd ever do that. In the real world. I know in the theoretical world that sounds great, but in the real world that's not going to happen, is it? The worst is, he might actually learn that barking doesn't get the door to come open. So he quickly switches to something. Now he's scratching the paint off the back of the door. Tell me any owner who would just sit there and wait for that to stop for 2 minutes. It's not going to happen, is it? So I can quickly give you, if you are prepared to sit for 2 minutes when all barking has ceased before you go in, thanks Mia. If you're prepared to sit for 2 minutes till all barking has ceased and only go in when it's quiet, over a period of time, that will certainly improve his behavior. But it's just, I don't know anyone who would. So it's a very quick cure. If you get a sheet off your bed and put it in that room, because we know that when he's barking at the door, he'll be close to the door. So we put the sheet on his side of the door with just the edge of the sheet on my side and sit near the door. And every time he barks, just pull the sheet. Earthquake! It's nothing to do with you, is it? You haven't done that. I know we've smelled the other side of the door, but he won't say, oh, it must be you doing that. And it will very quickly stop the behavior. It works great with dogs that have a high center of gravity, you know, the sort of greyhounds, any tall breed of dog. Don't do it to a terrier. You get hold to pull and he's already got hold and you bang your head on the door as he pulls. Okay, so again, there isn't a cure all for every single dog. It depends on the breed of dog. Sometimes this is the cure that we use. So the idea is, and that's called an environmental correction. In other words, that hasn't changed the puppy's relationship with me. When I go in, he's still pleased to see me. As long as I don't shout before I do that, that this isn't anger, he'll associate barking with a little bit of a ground tremor and quiet with me coming, and he'll still be happy to see me. Of course, if he's barking, I go in and beat him, He'll still bark when I leave him. The only thing that will change is my relationship. So now for the rest of his life, I've got a dog that doesn't trust me. And that's never, you don't ever want to have a child that doesn't trust you. You don't ever want to have a dog that doesn't trust you. So very simple solution to a lot of attention-seeking behaviors. So then we've got the other one, haven't we? A bizarre one that I was asked to deal with, border collies, always border collies. When my husband comes in, as soon as my husband comes in, you know, I'm watching television, my husband comes in, I go to greet my husband, our border collie starts headbutting the furniture. Bizarre behavior. What have you tried to stop it? I've tried putting the dog on a down, I've tried to get him to sit, I've tried getting my husband to come in with dog treats to distract him, but it hasn't stopped it. Okay, this is what I want you to do. As soon as your husband comes in and the dog starts headbutting the furniture, both of you stand up, walk out of the room, storm out of the room and slam the door in disgust. She came back 3 days later and said, it's like a miracle. See, what I've done now, the dog, as soon as he headbutts, he realizes that actually loses everything. You can't put the dog out because that gives him attention. If you immediately walk out, slam the door, the dog says, oh, what did I do? And border collies are quite quick. They work out, oh, it must be the headbutting that I'm making them leave. Okay, everything that they tried was actually only giving the dog attention. So I want you to think carefully about that. We'll talk about dogs that that are destructive. We're going to call this insecurity. So it's a lesser version of separation anxiety. This is the one, the dog's okay when he knows I'm around in the house somewhere. It's only when I go out. It's only whenever I go out. And then he starts to chew things, or then he starts to bark. It's only ever when I go out. Well, I know some of you might think otherwise, but in my lifetime, I've only ever discovered that dogs have five senses. Five, that's all, five senses. I know some people think there's a sixth sense. Common sense, probably. So we quickly talk about the five senses. That's how they take in information about the world around them. So remember I said earlier, if the dog's fine with me and I'm a human being, he's fine with my partner, she's a human being, why isn't the dog fine with you? Because you're human beings. It will be something in his senses that is overreacting. And typically it will be how you smell. So you will see a lot of our community, Wyoming is exactly the same, Jackson Hole is exactly the same, a lot of the community that own dogs smell like dogs. So your dogs already know, they'll meet people out on the trail, they'll know who has a dog and who doesn't. And some of them will quickly discriminate. They are worried about people who don't own a dog because they smell strange. I've never ever smelled anyone who doesn't smell like a dog. If you work at a shelter, working with dogs, and you then decide to leave the shelter and perhaps get a different job, for how long after you've left the shelter will any dog that's ever been in shelter in its life not recognize you as a shelter worker? Anyone know? How long will it take to get the smell of the shelter off your clothes? About 10 years. That's why your dogs, if you work in a shelter, dogs that have been in the shelter will recognize you quicker than they'd recognize me.
What do you think about sharing of commensal bacteria as a reason behind that? Like sharing your normal flora that's on your skin, on your dog's feet, the reason dogs have Frito feet, their skin bacteria. You think that plays a role in how you smell?
Absolutely. Okay. Yeah. And all the disinfectants they use are the same all around the world, aren't they? Yeah, everything. And that impregnates your clothes, and then you put those clothes into a washing machine with your other clothes, and you hang them in the closet with your other clothes, and you cross-contaminate everything. I know, because, you know, I train or work with detection agencies all around the world, cross-contamination of scent. So it takes about 10 years. So in other words, dogs will distinguish or discriminate between dog owners and non-dog owners. Okay, so I want you to think about that. So I've got a puppy, and I need it to introduce it to everyone in my community. But more and more what's happening is we're introducing our puppies, especially in puppy socialization classes, not to everyone in our communities. We're introducing them to dog people within our communities. And there is a difference. So, a little tip. Next time you get a puppy, if you can't get lots of non-dog
friends to come and visit, and you know, borrow the puppy overnight, look after it overnight, that's what we do. And share them out a little bit. So they're not worried about anyone.
If you can't do that, go to Salvation Army or the thrift store, buy a big bag of old clothes, Because they smell of everyone in your community. And every day that you come in, wear a different jacket when you come in. And you'll desensitize the dog to everyone in your community. Mm-hmm. Works like magic for a young puppy that's a little bit worried about people it doesn't know. And that'd be based on smell. See, dogs are very simple. They're a product of those five senses. So it's what they smell, what they see, what they hear, what they feel. And you can desensitize a dog or make it less sensitive to anything, or you can make it very sensitive to certain things. In training a detection dog, we make it sensitive to a particular smell. Or you can make the dog completely insensitive. Like most people, when they get a puppy, first thing they do is they desensitize it to the name that they called it. Well, they use the name over and over, expecting the dog by some miracle knows exactly what it is they want. You know, Mia, 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 Mia. Yes, that's me, what do you want? No instructions. And so they learn to switch off. Now, I daren't say this. It was just some of my friends said it's like living with a nagging wife. You know, you don't hear them in the end. I've never said that. You know, it was my friend. Okay, so we're talking about the dog that if I leave it by itself, it will bark or it's destructive. But it's okay when it knows I'm in the house. If I'm upstairs vacuuming, if I'm talking to a friend on the phone, if I'm just out in the backyard doing a little bit of mowing, the dog is fine. It's only when I go out. Don't tell it you go out. Fix the problem. Fix the problem like that. Just don't tell it you go. It's only got five senses. It's not psychic. No such thing as a psychic, is there? There's a test. See if they have a front doorbell. If they have a front doorbell, can't be psychic, can they? I'd have a closed circuit TV camera if I was advertising as psychic. And when you went and knock or ring, I'd open the door and say, come in, I've been expecting you. And you say, he's psychic. Okay. So there are five senses. So I just want you to think about this concept. If we know the dog is okay when you're in the house, it means because it can hear you in the house. It can certainly smell when you're in the house. Okay, so it's those two senses. It can hear, it can see, it can smell. So the trick is, with any separation problem, and I'm talking about house, not crate. Okay, I would not put a dog in a crate to solve these problems. You have to put the dog into an area of the house, and that's the difficulty of the USA. Your houses are much more open plan. Whereas in the UK, we actually close off every room with a door because it's much colder. So it's a little bit more difficult in the USA. But the dog has to be restricted to one part of the house. If when you go out, it has to run at the house, well, even a stupid dog would very quickly run around the house and say, oh, you've gone out. Because it has to be restricted. And it's better if it's restricted to an area of the house where it can't actually see the exit. Okay? Remember that for later. It can't see the exit. So all I'm going to do now, remember, he's okay if he's in that area, as long as he knows I'm in the house. So all I've got to do whenever I go out is take an item of recently worn clothing. He's in that room, remember. Put it just outside the door on my side. And when I go out, he'll smell the bottom of the door and he'll think I'm still in the room. And if I switch on a tape recorder of me vacuuming, talking to a friend on the phone, he'll hear I'm still in the house. And he'll be absolutely fine. Because remember, you said he's fine if he knows you're in the house. Don't tell him that you go out. It's so simple. Or you'd think it would be so simple, the way that I've explained it. So I have to tell you, during there was a TV program, one of our big national rescues, and I happened to be doing a lecture for the staff on dog behavior, teaching them about dog behavior. And the television camera was there, and the producer came up and she said, you know, do you mind if we just do a short clip after lunch of you doing the lecture, just to explain on national TV that the staff here get training on dog behavior? Well, it doesn't bother me, it's fine. So they set up the cameras and they did this. But the problem was, she then became fascinated by the talk on dog behavior, fascinated by what I was saying. And she came up to me and she said, you know, like when we finish this, the program that we're filming here, can I talk to you about one of the dogs at this center as placed in a home? Because the guy is thinking he may have to bring it back because he can't leave it by itself because it barks and is sometimes a little bit destructive. And I said, yeah, I can probably help with that. And she said, well, let me show you it. And she looks through the footage and I saw it on a 4-inch monitor. So I watched the dog, I listened to the bark and I could see the dog. And I immediately diagnosed, it's called insecurity. Okay, the dog's just feeling a bit insecure. Some rescue dogs do feel a bit insecure. So it's, again, repeatable pattern of behaviour. So again, an insecurity bark is a little bit different from an attention-seeking bark. So, okay, a bit different. That's very different to excitement, okay? So we've got a little bit of panting, a little bit of sort of hyperventilation, and the pacing behaviour, where the dog's pacing up and down, okay? So that's what I diagnosed. Rightly or wrongly, I've diagnosed it. It's an insecurity issue. So I explain, you know, when he goes out, this is what I want him to do. And I only saw it on the phone, and I never spoke to the guy. So I'm talking to a TV producer who's going to explain it to an owner, and the TV producer knows nothing about dogs. And I'm shown on national TV to be a complete idiot. So she explains it to the owner, and they film it. So they see this, it's an old guy with this young sort of mutt, and this old guy, and you see him put the dog in this room. So he puts it in the room. The exit is here, so he's going to walk out of his house here. That's the front door, and the stairs are here. So he puts the dog in this room and closes the door. And then he takes off his shirt. He's still got a string vest on. He takes off his shirt, carefully, neatly folds it, and puts it just by the door here. Then he goes upstairs, puts on another shirt, and comes downstairs, and switches on the tape recorder just here, just on the little shelf, switches it on, and then quietly goes out. It's a glass door. So the dog shouldn't have visual association of seeing you leave. So it taught me a lot. Okay, so separation problem is really easy. Let's quickly talk about a puppy that's becoming a bit food aggressive, really easy to solve. Yeah, and I keep looking at that, I can't believe it's going so fast. So we'll talk about, I've got a puppy and I've got it from a breeder and it's a little bit food aggressive. That's the air snap. And if I push it, it'll probably bite me. Okay, so the air snap. Remember, there's several different ways that you can handle it. There's not just one way. You could manage it, couldn't you? You could only ever feed the puppy when you put him inside a crate, close the door, and there he's not. So no one's going to, he won't bite anyone. Or if you want to solve the problem, very, very simple solution. But it shows the difficulty of solving behavior problems, even though it's actually very simple for me to say. Okay, so when you approach him, he eats faster and you get that little air snap. And this is how you solve the problem. First of all, look at the dog's diet. If he's eating food that 9 out of 10 dogs prefer, find the one that 9 out of 10 dogs didn't really care for. Now, that should be obvious, shouldn't it? If you're feeding him a diet that's so palatable, well, he's more likely to guard it from you. So just go and find some rubbish food that he's not that interested in. It's an obvious one. And that will help. And then all you need to do is put this rubbish food in three separate bowls placed 8 feet apart in a triangle. One there, one there, one there. So you put the food in there, this rubbish food, bulk it out if you can, put some bran or something in, you know, grated carrots, anything to bulk it out a little bit, and put it down, three separate bowls. Because the problem with modern packaged food, it's such a small quantity, isn't it? I can't believe that dogs actually are full after they've eaten that tiny little amount. So we put the food in these three bowls. About 8 feet apart, and then walk away, let the puppy in, and because we're talking about solving food aggression with the young dog, when he comes in, so we're going to call him bowl A, B, and C. Whichever bowl he goes to eat from, walk. So he goes to bowl A, walk to bowl B, and pick it up, and let him see you put a few pieces of chicken on top, and put that bowl back down. He'll leave the rubbish now and come and eat the chicken. And as he comes there, walk away from the bowl and pick up bowl C, and let him see you put a piece of chicken on. And keep rotating around the bowls. I guarantee within 2 days, when he's eating out of any of the bowls and you walk towards one of the bowls, he'll leave the bowl he's eating from, wag his tail and come to you. You can have to pick up the one he was eating from and put the chicken on. Very, very simple fix. It doesn't put anyone at risk. But here's the problem. The owner then says to me, the magic words, it's worked like magic, it's great. I can now pick up the one he's eating from, and he trusts me, he's wagging his tail. In other words, I've now convinced the puppy, I'm not going to take anything away. My presence around the food bowls adds something better. But then the owner says the magic words, when can I go back to feeding him out of one bowl? The answer is never. Once you've changed his behavior by changing your behavior, you can't go back. If you go back to how it was, feeding food that 9 out of 10 dogs prefer out of one bowl, he'll go back to his old behavior. See, that's the problem, isn't it? Is that when people get these behavior programs, it's often not explained to them they last for the lifetime of the dog. So the best advice I can give you, get a puppy from a breeder, you've had it for a week and it's food aggressive, take it back to the breeder and get your money back. I know most people wouldn't do that. But if we could get people to do that, breeders would be a lot more careful about how they raise their puppies, wouldn't they? Okay. So that's a very simple solution to food aggression. Do you want me to quickly give you the complete house training program, complete house breaking program?
Before, yep. Do you give any merit to hand feeding puppy for food aggression? Because I've heard that from a lot of places.
Yeah, the great thing about dog behavior, there's not a right or wrong answer. It's whatever works. There's also scatter feeding. Leave the food down all day long. And then a lot of dogs, because food is the bowl is constantly topped up, they've got nothing to guard. But then your Labrador explodes eventually. With some breeds, it's okay, you can do that. You feed them ad lib. And some will only eat to appetite, but a lot, they'll just keep eating and eating. Look at what you're feeding. That's the important thing. So there's several different strategies. If the dog's actually, okay, the worst case of food aggression is where the dog leaves the food. So you enter the room, or the food's up on the shelf, you go near, and the dog actually attacks you, going near the food. That's the worst case. And even those you can turn around. And you can turn around in no time at all. And again, I'll quickly explain how to do it. Whether the owner would go to these lengths or not, again, is a completely different matter. But there is a very easy fix. If I had a dog in the shelter, I certainly would do this. Because I can't rehome a dog that's food aggressive. I simply can't do it. I would never rehome a dog that's food aggressive. And it all, okay, so many different branches to this tree. I'll show you how I test a dog for food aggression. It's the only way you can do it. Tether the dog and put a bowl down with the best food you can find. So put some chicken, minced lamb, anything at all in that bowl. And tether the dog. And it has to be a big bowl, about that diameter and shallow. The dog's tethered. His nose can only reach halfway across the bowl. And you filled it up with that food. If you walk and put your hand in the bowl, the dog will tell you if he's aggressive or not. I'm not a big believer in a plastic hand. Which is some shelters use. Okay, that's the only test for food aggression. The problem is, see, if I'm a member of shelter staff and I really like the dog and know it's going to be tested for food aggression, I can actually fake it so the dog passes the test, can't I? Perhaps I shouldn't tell you how to do it. Well, what you do is you feed the dog his normal food, but double the quantity on the morning of the test, and then feed him something that he doesn't normally get. So he's had his old two bowls of kibble, he only normally gets one, and he's leaving half of the second bowl because he's full. And then you say, how about some chicken? Here, have some chicken. Oh, I'll have some chicken, whole roast chicken, and then some turkey, and then some ham, until the dog says, oh, I'm stuffed. Honestly, I couldn't eat another thing. Come on, one more morsel. Until the dog is saying, no, honestly, I'll be sick if I have any more, and then deliver the dog for a food test, and he'll pass, won't he? So, sometimes increasing the number of times a day that you feed the dog will decrease food aggression. And how about, well, he's not aggressive over food, it's only if he gets a piece of chicken. So if he gets a chicken leg, I can't get near him. That's a simple one, isn't it? When was the last time you gave him chicken? Well, you feed him chicken every day for the next month, he won't want chicken anymore, will he? You see, we don't feed dogs what we eat anymore. Let's just quickly do John Henry, toy poodle, and then we'll get back to subject. John Henry, the toy poodle. Owners phone me, listen to this carefully. They phone me and say, out on a walk, when we're taking him out for a walk, he picks up the most disgusting things and tries to eat them. That's remarkable. I've never, ever known a dog pick up anything he finds disgusting. It's only owners who find it disgusting. For the dog, it's the biggest gourmet food item it could ever have. And they said, well, he picked up this sort of piece of chicken leg with some meat left on it, and he wouldn't let my husband take it from him. And he carried it all the way home. And when we got home, my husband had to tie the lead to the leg of a table and put on gauntlets and get the fire tongs to take the bone away. And I said, what did your husband do with the bone when he took it away? And he said, well, he threw it in the trash. In the kitchen, you know, put it in the trash can. I said, but the dog doesn't know it's trash. To the dog, that is the secret stash of the most exciting food that's in the house. And the dog is certain that every night when he's asleep, you sneak down there and you go and gorge yourselves on it. So I just want you to think about that concept. The dog doesn't know it's trash. And I said to them, when was the last time you actually gave him cooked chicken? And this dog was like 3 years old. He'd never had cooked chicken. Isn't that sad? It's got to be the saddest thing ever in a dog's life. Okay, if you have children, do you make them sit at a different table and feed them different food to what you have? No, actually we share, don't we? People have stopped doing that with their dogs. I don't know what, well, it's good food manufacturers have got their advertising pretty good. If we shared more of our lives with our dogs, we'd have better dogs, but we don't. We're now segregating. We're segregating dogs from our lives, we're segregating them from the community. Please don't open a dog park in this area. It immediately segregates dogs from the community. It's the worst thing that we've ever done with dogs. Dogs used to be part of a community. We used to have children interacting with dogs. In the UK, it's illegal to take any dog except a guide dog specifically into an area where children are playing. Okay, you mustn't let that happen here. Okay, coming back to our food aggression. Worst case scenario of food aggression. This is a dog that will bite. Remember, there's different solutions to it. One solution is just to scatter food all over the backyard and close the door. And sometimes that will help. By feeding the dog less valuable food, sometimes by feeding what you're eating, you'll find it will help. I promise you it will help. But if I've got the dog tethered, now, just think about this concept. Tethered, I've got a big bowl, fairly shallow, about that diameter, so it's big diameter. And I've got the dog tethered, so I know his nose can't reach further than half of that bowl, which means his teeth can't make contact, only on his side of the bowl. And I pile food on my side of the bowl. And I walk, so I've got the food set up, he's tethered, and now tips of food on my side of the bowl, and I walk away. And I look at the dog. Until he looks at me, and when he looks at me, I say, what do you want? Honestly, this is how I do it. I promise it's how I do it. You know, what do you want? Oh, you want some food? You can't reach it. Hold on, let me help you. Look, doesn't matter what he does, I'm going to approach the bowl, put my hand in my side, and flick a few pieces across and walk away. In 5 minutes, he's begging me to come and put my hand in his bowl, isn't he? We change the relationship by doing stuff like that. Once I've got that, we then use three bowls tethered on a sort of semicircle, and then I'm going to do the rubbish food in each of the three bowls. I'm the one with the chicken. And once I've got that, I can then untether him and do it triangular. And we can solve problems like that. So that is specifically a dog that is guarding its food bowl. But you have to ask, why is the dog guarding its food bowl? It's doing it because it doesn't trust the owner. It doesn't trust the owner to share anything with it. So next time you get a puppy, teach it the concept of sharing. Most valuable thing you'll ever teach a puppy, it's the most valuable thing you'll ever teach a child, the concept of sharing with others. So I want you to think about the concept. We do it by teaching a puppy to retrieve. So I've got, how about a golden cocker spaniel? Because they suffer from all kinds of different problems, don't they? Sorry, owners of golden cocker spaniel suffer from... you can't really separate the behavior of the dog from the owner. You profile the owner. So we've got this golden cocker spaniel, and when it's been bred with an instinct. Cocker spaniel named, anyone have a cocker spaniel? Don't answer. named after, how does it get its name? Named after the quarry that it hunts, so it's woodcock, that's how it gets its name. Springer spaniel is the hunting habit, working in tall heather. Okay, so a cocker spaniel, it's been bred from a long line of working cocker spaniels, and when it's a puppy, it picks something up it's not supposed to have, and the owners run around shouting, drop it, leave it, drop it. What they should have said is, good boy, fetch it. That's the first mistake. They didn't understand the dog. They didn't understand that if they'd actually encouraged the dog to bring it to them, this is the concept of sharing, and the dog had bought it to them, and they put their hands all over the dog and said, what a wonderful dog you are, it'd have ended up with a great dog. But chasing it around and shouting, drop it, so the dog now drops it, and it's the owner who's threatening the dog, we end up with a dog that some people say suffers from idiopathic rage syndrome. It doesn't actually exist, the owners that suffer from that. Well, that's what the dog would argue. There was a study done in the UK in the early part of the 80s when we had so much of a problem with golden cocker spaniel rage syndrome. It's believed to be some kind of a medical condition. And there are some conditions, some medical conditions, that will result in a dog becoming aggressive. If it's in constant pain, it will may well become aggressive or reactive. And there was a study, I think the guy was called Anthony Podbersky from Cambridge University, contacted a lot of veterinarians and said, when you diagnose idiopathic rage syndrome, idiopathic means I have no idea why he's doing it. But it just sounds really clever, doesn't it? So he keeps getting bad tempered, I have no idea why. Idiopathic rage syndrome. So he contacted veterinarians and people that were dealing with dog behavior and said, if you diagnose that and then euthanize the dog, could you dissect it and send the brain down to me, because he was studying brain abnormalities in the breed. And he contacted me, you know, amongst lots of other people. And I responded. And I said, but what about the owner's brains? Surely we need to... shouldn't you be looking for abnormalities in Golden Cocker Spaniel owner's brain?
Because you can't say that that dog is behaving independently from its role model. It's the same. So what we actually found, an awful lot of people who own Golden Cocker Spaniels that had rage syndrome were middle-aged females, kids had left home, and these were mothers who were stay-at-home mums that liked to nurture their kids. The kids had left,
and they needed something to nurture. And they're not going to get a German Shepherd, are they? A lot of Borzoi or anything. So Golden, and it was often the kids that had bought them the dog. But the second part of their profile was they're incredibly house proud. So you see, in my house, if a puppy chews up a little sweet wrapper and puts it on the floor, well, there's enough to go around for everyone, isn't there? But if you're very house proud, that would be a problem. You want to pick up immediately and challenge the puppy over it. And this was what was causing the problem. It was owners challenging the puppies over the stupidest things that real dog owners wouldn't have worried about. You know, puppy, okay, he's going to chew a bit of cardboard. But if it's really important to you and you challenge him over it in no time at all, all the puppies, all these young dogs were telling me that their owners suffer from idiopathic rage syndrome. I don't know why, if suddenly for no reason, they get really annoyed, really aggressive, their eyes glaze over, they start to show their teeth. And some of them even guard a piece of fluff on the carpet. That's what they're telling them about the owners. Okay, to solve the problem, if you have a dog that is possessive and aggressive over something, all you need to do is teach it to retrieve. That's how we solve the problem. You just teach it to retrieve. It's the concept of sharing. It should be taught in every puppy training class. Some cultures actually do teach dogs to retrieve. More and more people are getting hunting breeds, we call them gun dogs, the ones that are bred to retrieve, and they're telling the puppy off when it picks something up and wants to retrieve it. And so it teaches the puppy to become possessive. So we have golden retrievers in the UK that actually behave sometimes more like Rottweilers than golden retrievers. It's because the owner who got the dog did not understand the instinct. So typical dog in the household, if it's a golden retriever, when you walk in, it's been by itself for a little while, when you walk in, it's pleased to see you, it will pick something up and it will move the whole of its rear end and go round and round your legs, want it to give you it as a gift. True? A border collie will pick something up, drop it at your feet and say, go on, throw it, I want to chase it. A Rottweiler will pick something up and say, you're not getting this. Just different breed instincts. So it is vital that puppies learn to share things with their owners. And we do it just by teaching retrieve. Simple exercise. Simplest thing you'll ever train a puppy to do, of any breed. Do you want to quickly do it? Okay, first of all, find something that the puppy's interested in. That might be a bit breed dependent. Remember, with a terrier, do not use a squeaky toy, because it will not have the instinct to bring it to you. The instinct will be to take it away somewhere and kill it. That's when the squeaker dies, it loses interest. Okay, so we don't use that. Use a piece of cloth that's knotted. It will still shake it, but it won't squeak to overexcite the dog. So find something that the dog wants. With each breed, the only reason they'll retrieve is based on the genetic instinct. The only reason a border collie will bring it to you is because it wants you to throw it. The only reason a Malinois Belgian Shepherd will bring it to you is because it wants you to try and take it. And the only reason that a golden retriever will bring it to you is because it wants to give it to you. Different breed instincts. So you have to understand that. So I've got my puppy, and when it's feeling playful, I've got one of my interactive toys, just a pattern of behavior. Well, perhaps do it, actually a lot of you didn't come at the weekend, so we can do a pattern of behavior with you. Okay, so I've got my puppy, I've got the toy, hold the toy in the same direction as a puppy, and throw it. And I normally throw it into the corner and have a coffee table there. Because the puppy will have an instinct, especially if there's been other, if there's been toys when it was raised in the litter, it will have the instinct, anything new or novel, it wants to examine it, will take it into a corner underneath or behind something. So we already know that. They're already programmed to do that. If it's something new and novel, they'll take it to a place where they can examine it. So I've got the puppy here, throw the toy in that direction, 9 out of 10, it will pick the toy up and go under here, lie down, flop down, and start to play with it, chew it, examine it. And all I've got to do is to walk over here, just carefully. I normally sit arm's length from my back to the puppy, put my hand out and stroke it. When you stroke it, you'll feel its muscles tense a little bit as it prepares to run away, so just keep stroking it. And then talk to it, calm it down. Don't touch the toy. You stroke the puppy. And if you aim for that little bit, it will do this and drop the toy. When it drops the toy, only when it makes the decision to drop the toy, you bring the toy back here with the puppy, tease it and throw it again. Do that 6 times. 6 times will form a pattern in its head. A lot of people found when they did the 3-day course, most things that we did, we only did 3 or 4 repetitions, and they learned it, hadn't they? 3 or 4 repetitions, they actually knew the whole thing. So 6 repetitions is enough. Irish setter, maybe 10 repetitions. And now, so this is a pattern. So the puppy now runs out, picks up, takes it under there, and it's a good experience. I'm not taking the toy away. He's allowed to investigate it. 6 times. The 7th time, I now stand here and throw the toy in that direction. When he goes to pick up, if I sit there, where do you think he'll bring it? That's how easy it is. Any breed of dog. 6 repetitions puts a pattern in. If you're trying to train a dog to do something and you've done it 3 times and the dog hasn't learnt it, don't do it another 300 times. Should learn it within 3 or 4 repetitions. 6 at the most. 6 will put a pattern in. We'll have to quickly do patterns of behaviour now. And those with me at the weekend, do not shout anything out. Okay, so we're going to do the face of the clock, the background colour. What colour is that? Shout it out.
White.
White, that's correct. How about that colour? What would you say that colour was? That's white as well. How about that light that's shining? What colour is that? Go on, you've got to be faster. How about the inside of this cup? What colour is that? White. Quick, what do cows drink?
Milk.
No, they actually drink water. They produce milk. Okay. It's a pattern of behaviour. See, when I repeated something 6 times, you can't step outside that pattern of behaviour. Same as our dog that barks when someone knocks at the door. The pattern is so strong, if you put the dog on a lead, took him out for a walk, stood back outside your own front door and knocked it, he'd still bark, wouldn't he? Okay, those patterns don't change. And your patterns don't change. This is why to change a dog's behaviour, we have to look at the owner's pattern of behaviour. It's your patterns that do this. So I've got, quickly got time, talk about dog-to-dog aggression. Is that's a big one? Yeah, okay. We can, I also want to do complete house train. Everyone know how to? This isn't how to housebreak a puppy. If you've got a dog that has not been housebroken, how you can do it. And I would guarantee you can do it, providing there's no medical problems. And I always say, oh, it worked well here. I always say, if I give you the program for complete housebreaking, this is not, remember, a puppy that how to housebreak. This is one where everything has failed. It's now an older dog. Maybe it's come from rescue. And rescue get it badly wrong with housebreaking, don't they? Perhaps I should do that as well. Okay, those of you from rescue, listen carefully. If a dog comes in as an owner hand in, we would always ask, what time of day do you take him out to go to the toilet? You always ask that question. If it comes in as an owner hand in. If it comes in as a stray, feed it exactly the same time every day. Exactly the same time every day. And keep a record, keep a diary of when it goes to the toilet. You'll find it was fairly consistent. And all you need to do then is get volunteers to come and take the dog out to an appropriate place when it needs to go to the toilet. Battersea Dogs Home at Windsor, they have housebreaking volunteers that come in. And they have dogs in those kennels 8 months that have never pooped in the kennel. You see, you put a dog in a kennel, and it's used to going to the toilet at 3 o'clock. 3 o'clock comes around, it can't raise its paw and say, could you tell me where the restroom is? It puts it under massive amounts of stress. And what's in the kennel? If the dog, most are housebroken. So if the dog has been housebroken, it now looks around the kennel for an alternative surface. If it's lying near the door, as most do, that is now why the dog will go to the toilet in its plastic dog bed. Just think about that. And then you see on the kennel card, not housebroken. OK, Okay, just think about it from the dog's perspective. So if you understand these patterns of behavior, honestly, you can make the dog stay in kennels so much easier. Okay, let's do the complete housebreaking thing. So remember, this is a dog that hasn't been housebroken properly, or whatever's been tried hasn't worked. If I give you the program, if it doesn't work, I'd refund every penny that it cost you to come to this seminar. Okay, I do this all around the world when people do pay money to come to the seminars. Let's quickly do it. I'm trying to solve every behavior problem in the time that I've got. Okay, first thing is look at the dog's diet. What you're looking for is a food that is 85% or greater in digestibility. The pet food manufacturers will not tell you this unless you specifically ask them. It's not written on the bag. 85% or greater in digestibility. What that means is, for every 100 grams of food that you feed the dog, if you weigh what comes out the rear end, if 15 grams comes out, it's digested 85%. Some of the really expensive foods are less than 50% digestible. Also, if you're feeding the dog too much, it will produce more feces. So you have to feed an 85% digestible diet in the correct quantity for your dog. On the bag of dog food, they'll always tell you to feed more than the dog actually needs. Okay, because it's not good for them if you feed a little bit too less and the dog starts to get thin on that dog food. I could do a whole lecture on dog food. Anyway, 85% or greater in digestibility. Make sure that the dog has been seen by a veterinarian and checked. Okay, there are some conditions where so an owner will say he even does it in his bed. Okay, but is he awake when he does it? Because if he's asleep when he does it, he needs to see a veterinarian. There are some conditions that will create this problem that have nothing to do with dog behavior. So the dog has to be cleared by a veterinarian, thoroughly checked by a veterinarian. Assuming there is no medical reason for the behavior, then this is all we need to do. So this is an owner who says he does it in the house. So first thing is, what does he do it on? What does he poop on? It's on the carpet. Okay, so we need to know that. That's called a preferred toileting surface. Does he ever do it in front of you? What's the common answer? Why do you think a dog wouldn't do it in front of the owner? Yeah, they feel guilty. Okay, they feel embarrassed. I could give you again scientific reasons why a dog wouldn't do it in front of the owner. Let's just say they feel embarrassed, because it's a quicker talk. So for whatever reason, most dogs will not do it in front of the owner. In fact, some owners will say, you can take him out for a walk, you can be out for an hour, he won't do a thing. But when you come back, as soon as your back is turned, okay? So that tells you the dog won't do it in front of the owner. That's very important information. Is there a particular location where he likes to do it? In the UK, it would be in the kitchen near the back door. That would be a very common one, or at the top of the stairs. Sometimes they'll sneak into the utility room and do it. So we're looking for a location and we're looking for surface. That's called preferred toileting surface. Okay, so we've switched the dog to an 85% digestible diet, and you have to feed it to the nearest minute exactly the same time every day. Let's assume we're going to feed it twice a day. Our dogs get fed once a day, but that's neither here nor there. Exactly the same time every day at the nearest minute. So we feed it, we're going to say 8 o'clock in the morning. And if you keep that consistent, there should be a consistent elimination time. Your dog should be going to the toilet no more than 3 times a day in 24 hours. If it's going more times a day than that, look at the food that you're feeding. It's not digestible enough, which produces more. Or you're feeding it too much. It should only be 3 times a day. On some foods, you feed it on fresh raw tripe, it will probably go twice a day. Okay, but I'm not a nutritionist, you know, check this out with a veterinarian or a nutritionist. So keep a diary. If I'm feeding exactly 8 o'clock, you'll find within a week there'll be a consistent elimination time. So let's say the elimination time is, just for argument's sake, we're going to say 11 o'clock. 11 o'clock today. If you want to manipulate the elimination time, by the way, just manipulate the feeding time. So I get phone calls this time of the year in the UK, well, usually a bit earlier than this. Well, you know when we change our clocks? And we forget to tell the dog. So they poop near the door. So the owner gets up, there's a pile of poop there, and they thought the dog was housebroken. And they phone me. You know, his house train has gone to pieces. They haven't connected it to the change in the clocks. So the dog expects to get to poop in the backyard at 7 o'clock, but now they're not getting up till 8 o'clock. And the dog can't wait. And they'll actually pay me for this advice. I'll say, set your alarm clock for 2 o'clock in the morning, and when it goes off, open your window, just quietly shout hallelujah 3 times, close the window. Within 2 weeks, the problem will be solved, and it always is, because they've changed the feed time by an hour. Okay, so you can manipulate elimination time by manipulating feed time. So exactly the same time every day. We know what surface he goes on, we know he doesn't want to do it in front of you. Now we can do a house training program. It's now, so we're going to say the danger time is 11 o'clock. Okay, he wants to go to the toilet, 11 o'clock usually. So about 10:30, you've got to restrict him to a surface he won't go to the toilet on. Sometimes that's his bed. If he, the best one I've found is your couch, because your dog's never pooped on your couch, has he? At least I hope he hasn't. It's usually a resting area where you rest. If the dog sleeps in the bedroom overnight, I bet he doesn't poop on the bed overnight, does he? Because you would have done something about that a long time ago, correct? Okay, so we call that a non-preferred toileting surface. So you restrict him to that. So you restrict him on your bed, you restrict him to his bed, or you restrict him to the couch. You can even take a cushion off the couch and put it in a crate. That will fix the problem. Okay, so that's half an hour before he needs to go to the toilet. And in that, the other thing you can do, if you don't have a non-preferred toileting surface, remember you said he won't do it in front of you, attach an umbilical cord at 10:30, because remember, he won't do it in front of you, will he? Okay, it's simple to solve. And out in my backyard, or where I want the dog to go to the toilet, I've got to set up, we call it a secretive area. So it's a three-sided area. You can plant some shrubs if you want. In the UK, we use the thing called a windbreak. It's like a canvas screen that when we go onto the beach, we put those, otherwise the sand will blow all over you. So three-sided area, and that's a secretive area. In other words, he can't be seen from anything more than one side, because dogs like to be secretive. An owner's already usually told me that. He won't do it in front of you. He sneaks off to a corner, to an area where we can't see him. So we've set that up for him. Remember, he can't be seen from all four sides. And in that area, I'm going to place a piece of his preferred toileting surface. That's the carpet. Don't worry about this. So you cut a piece of carpet out the middle of your carpet. And just has to be representative of the carpet. And you place it there, and it helps if it's got his the smell of his urine and his own urine and feces on it. So it'd be rubber gloves and then remove it, because that helps. It's his own toileting area. And it's now 11 o'clock, so I'm going to lead him to that area, to that surface. And I'm going to have a handful of tiny little pieces of chicken or cheese and scatter it in a circle, not on the surface, but around the surface, and release him. And I'm just going to release him and go out the way, remember, because he won't do it in front of me. And if I check 5 minutes later, he will poop there. So why have I put the chicken or the cheese? Why have I done that in a circle? What do puppies do before they go to the toilet? Circle. Sniff and circle. That's what we've done. At a time he needs to go to the toilet, in a secretive area, on a surface that he likes to go to the toilet, on that smells of his own urine and feces, if I can get him to sniff and circle, it's a guarantee he will go to the toilet. And remember, when I come out and I see, oh, he's pooped there, I don't have to say, oh, what a clever dog. Okay, it's naturally rewarding behavior for him anyway at the time he does it. Okay, so you don't really have to acknowledge that. By the way, if you can predict when he's going to do it, you know, just watch over the top, you can predict when he's going to do it. You can actually teach him to do it on command. Isn't that amazing? Guide dogs are all trained to go to the toilet on command, so you can do that. You just have to predict when he's going to do it and add a key word. He's now free until half an hour before the next danger time, because you've got that on your list. But I don't really want him to keep going to the toilet on carpet. So after he's done it a few times, I'm slowly going to cover that carpet with the ultimate toileting surface that I want him to go to the toilet on. Leaves, gravel, paved surface, slowly cover it. So you can train the dog on any surface you want. And then after about a month, you can dig up the old surface, throw it away, you've retrained on a new surface. That's how assistance dogs now are trained to go to the toilet on a cruise ship. They do it on a piece of synthetic grass in the shower cubicle. You train the dog to do it where you want. Or the dog will do it wherever he wants. But there's a bit more. You've also got to clear the area where he's pooped in the house. You've actually got to clean that area and remove the smell. And there's only one thing that will do it. And that's the washing powder in solution with the water that you wash your clothes in. Don't go and buy things from the veterinarians, you know, that's supposed to, or design. Because all you're going to do, if you bring something in from outside and try and clean that area, you'll attract the dog back to the area to sniff. And when he goes back there and sniff, doesn't matter what you put on it, other than the washing powder that you wash your clothes in, you'll find he'll sniff and he'll probably poop again. Remember the washing powder that you wash your own clothes when the house already smells, that's not a new smell. He won't investigate it. And it will take you about a week to get rid of the smell. That's the only thing. See, it hasn't cost you any money. It's only a little bit of washing powder in solution with water. So you can retrain the dog on any surface at all, just looking at these patterns of behavior. Remember, if the dog's going to the toilet at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and you're feeding 8 o'clock in the morning, and you want him to go to the toilet at 4 o'clock, feed him 1 hour later, consistently. You can manipulate any way at all that you want. So there's a complete house training fix. Now let's do, the words are gonna come faster. Dog-to-dog aggression, dog-to-people aggression. Well, do dog-to-dog aggression, because it's now an epidemic in your country, and it's become an epidemic in the UK, but it's not in other countries. There are a lot of factors. Not one single factor, but I can isolate all the things that actually cause it to happen. This is the hard bit. Again, I can give you all the evidence you ever need from traveling around the world. So as an example, one of the worst areas that we've come across in the USA for dog-to-dog aggression, I know now people are calling it reactivity, okay, it's aggression, isn't it? It's an act of aggression. One of the worst areas in the USA seems to be Florida. That has to be the worst state of all the ones that I've visited is for this type of aggression to occur. In Beijing in China, they don't actually have leash aggression, there's no such thing. So again, you have to look at what's different in that culture to our culture. So what's different in Beijing, Mia? Owners within the 5 ring roads of Beijing, what are the rules for owning a dog?
Each family is only allowed one dog. So they are family dog, they're part of a family. How about the size of the dog?
From shoulder, 25 centimeters.
So to the dog's shoulder, it can't be higher than 35 centimeters. Okay.
So you will see small breeds of dog up to sort of Springer, just a bit bigger than Springer Spaniel size, walking around in the middle of Beijing with their owners, no leash, no interest in other dogs. They're a family dog, the way it used to be in the UK, the way I'm guessing it used to be in the USA. These are members of the owner's family. They do not cross the road to greet one another. They walk past one another. And I've never seen dog-to-dog aggression there. And I go there often, same in Shanghai. But if you go to Taiwan, which is actually part of the People's Republic of China, you'll see dog-to-dog aggression everywhere, because they've taken their influences in dogs from the UK and from the USA, whereas China hasn't yet. So it's influences in behavior. There's a lot of fact, there isn't one, on a talk of this length, I can only give you some of the influences and the ones that I think are the most important. So first of all, if you look in most countries of the world, you'll see that an increase in leash reactivity, if we want to call it that, or dog-to-dog aggression, seems to coincide with the advent in every culture of puppy socialization classes. Okay, and don't take my word for that, just have a look yourself. Countries that don't have puppy socialization classes and owners only own one dog, they normally don't have any problems. So that's one of the contributing factors. So you know why puppy socialization classes came into being. It doesn't mean if you're running one you're doing anything wrong, by the way, but we need to talk about it. You know, history has shown that that has actually been a backward step in dog ownership. Okay, so the first thing is, in the UK, in the 20s, 30s, 40s, less than 1% of our dog-owning population owned a second dog. Less than 1%. It currently stands at 37% of all the people who own a dog in the UK own a second dog. Why would anyone want a second dog? So I don't mean here. Why do you think anyone would own a second dog? If you just want a great family pet, why would you own a second one? Go on, shout it out. Company. Keep the first one company, which means you shouldn't have really had the first dog. So you bought it a pet dog of its own. I just want you to think about that concept. So we've seen in the UK, almost mirrored, increase in multi-dog households, an increase in people being admitted to hospital in emergency rooms because they've been injured by dogs. It almost mirrors. It goes up exactly the same. How about mixed breed dogs in the UK? Again, less than 1% in the 20s in the UK, less than 1% of our population owned a purebred dog. It's now 87%. 87% of people own a dog that was never developed to be a pet dog. Weimaraner was never developed to live in someone's house as a pet dog. It was designed as a working dog. You see very, very few companion dogs. And I say, in the UK, most of the companion dogs we've made extinct anyway. We bring in breeds like Russian Black Terriers. Not the same. If you're a dog enthusiast, there's nothing wrong in getting a Russian Black Terrier. If you just want a great pet dog, you could have made a better choice than a Russian Black Terrier. If you see what I mean, there's a difference between being a dog enthusiast and being someone who just wants a great family pet. So the two things. So puppy socialization class, you know why they came about, because the first dog park opened in California, anywhere in the world. And there was a problem in the dog park. Because in the dog park, people were taking family pets. And they were having trouble because they weren't feral. In other words, they weren't integrating with the other dogs. And so puppy socialization classes started, not deliberately with this aim, but we found out puppy socialization classes, they were aimed at getting dogs into a dog park that got on with one another. In other words, let's teach our puppies more pack mentality, how to behave as a feral dog, and we stopped them being family companions. We saw the same happen in the UK. Exactly the same thing happened. So, again, if you opened a dog park in Jackson Hole, Wyoming, how many dogs have you got in Jackson, Wyoming? Just as a rough guess.
10,000.
How big is the dog park going to be for 10,000 dogs? It's just not going to work, is it? So, the problem was, to get dogs into a dog park where they could run around and play and integrate with one another, a different type of socialization was needed, and it was called puppy socialization. It was socializing them with other dogs to change their behavior. The problem then occurred where it was noted in one of these dog parks, someone was taking the dog there in the morning and dropping it off when they went to work and collecting it in the evening, and that's how doggy daycare started up. Okay, so there's many factors. So one factor is people are getting breeds of dog that they know nothing about, that they can't control, and dogs that were never bred to live in someone's house as a family companion. Not that you can't, with some of these breeds, turn them into a family companion, as long as you understand the breed that you've got and you train it. Okay, the training is the essential part. So that's one of the problems. People owning more than one dog, when really one is all you need. And then this strange belief, because of puppy socialization class, this very strange belief that your dog needs dog friends. Your dog needs a friend, it doesn't need a dog friend. You know, and if you fully believe that your dog, its life is not fulfilled unless it has a lot of dog friends, well, okay, don't spay and neuter them, because a bitch's life is not fulfilled unless she's had at least one litter of puppies, true? Okay, just, I'm trying to challenge the way that you think about dogs. What you have to accept, whether you like it or not, whether I'm right or wrong, what you have to accept is we are placing more and more restrictions on dogs, and we're reducing more and more freedoms that dog owners have, and we are segregating more and more dog owners from our communities. You have to accept that. So we have to change something. And the only way we'll change it is by rethinking the whole situation. So I want you to think about socialization. Every puppy needs to learn two languages. It has to have a basic understanding of canine language, which it already has at 6 weeks, because its mother should have taught it that. And it has to be fluent in human language. If it's fluent in canine language and has no understanding of human language at all, only fluent in canine language, that's the recipe for a disaster, and that's the recipe for dog-to-dog aggression. Let me quickly do dog-to-dog aggression, because when you got it as a puppy, it wasn't aggressive towards other dogs, was it? No one gets a puppy that's then immediately aggressive towards other dogs. And if it is, just take it back to the breeder. It's a situation that the owners have created. Okay, so we have to look at the profile of a person. It's people that create these problems. I've worked with dogs 50 years. I've never owned a dog that was dog aggressive, nor could I. I don't fit that profile. You have to fit a profile. Any behavior problem with the dog, remember, I'm looking at your behavior, not the dog's. Okay, so let me talk you through it. I'll give you recipes in the ingredients for dog-to-dog aggression. Okay, you can have all the ingredients, still not have the problem. But every ingredient I add to this list increases the probability at some stage that you'll end up with a dog-to-dog aggression problem. Guide Dogs for the Blind in the UK since 1927. To be a puppy walker, puppy raiser, the rule was you couldn't have another dog, because they wanted their dogs to be raised to learn human language. So being a puppy raiser, I didn't own a dog, so I'd be a puppy raiser for guide dogs. If in, I don't know, the year 2000, I contacted guide dogs and said, look, I've got a dog and I want to be a puppy raiser, they'll say, I'm sorry. Why do you think they would say that? Because they want a person to be a role model for a guide dog. It's not a good thing for a guide dog to drag a blind owner across the road to say hi to a dog on the other side of the road, is it? Okay? They had to change their policy about 6-7 years ago because they run out of puppy raisers. And they had to relax the policy and let people raise a puppy, become up until about 7-8 months of age, that already had a dog. And their rejection rate went up through the roof. And the reason for rejection was, well, they won't say dog-to-dog aggression. They're going to say dog attraction. It's now more attracted to other dogs than it is the person that's supposed to be training it or the blind person. Massive rejection rate. So I just want you to think about this. So when we get a puppy, it will have learned enough canine communication to get by. When I go to, and I want you to just consider this, when I go to Beijing, I don't speak Chinese, but I use an interpreter, so me as my interpreter in China. So I just want you to think about this concept. The best time to teach a puppy your language is usually between the age of 6 and 12 weeks. The best time to teach it. You can do it up to about 16 weeks. So I want you to think about how your ancestors did it. They would take a puppy from a litter, and it would be taken into their house. They wouldn't have another dog. That's not been your tradition or ours. They wouldn't have another dog. It would become part of the family. It would eat what the family ate. It would be with the family. And our families were much closer together then. So our cousins who lived along the road would share the puppy. It might spend a night or two with our neighbors. So it would be part of, the puppy would actually be integrated into our community. So getting a puppy, what I want you to think about is 3 to 6 weeks it will learn canine language. That's called primary socialization periods, where it learns to be a dog. 6 to 12 weeks, and it's been documented. I'm not the first person to say this. Everyone's known about this for thousands of years. So I'm not the first person to say it. There's something called a secondary socialization period, where remarkably, unlike any other animal, your dog can learn to be any species. It's remarkable that we can do that with dogs, how we've genetically programmed that in. So your dog can learn to be any species. Dr. Michael Fox in the USA did his experiments in 1974, where he took a litter of puppies, 6 to 12 weeks, and put them with litters of rabbits. And he found that they could actually communicate with the rabbits. These puppies became rabbit. They were stressed when they were separate. They suffered separation anxiety when they were taken and didn't understand people or other dogs. Isn't that amazing? I'm going to say he wasted a lot of research time in his life, because the Anatolian shepherds have known it for thousands of years. You take a puppy away from a litter, put it with a flock of sheep or goats, it becomes one with them. And will protect the sheep or goats from predators, won't it? So it learns to speak goat. We've stopped doing that. What we've done in lots of countries is we've taken a puppy 6 weeks, 7 weeks, 8 weeks, and the tendency is now to get them later and later, so you've missed it already. They've already been with other dogs for too long. And instead of integrating them into a human family, we socialize them more with other dogs. So they become attracted to other dogs, and they don't understand humans anymore. And you've seen it in different countries around the world where that happens. They say the biggest contrast, Beijing in China and Taichung in Taiwan. That's the biggest contrast. Influences come from two different countries. So, I just want you to consider this. I'm going to give you recipes for dog-to-dog aggression, or ingredients. So I get a dog, Under the age of three, that will give me a better ingredient. So it's already under the age of three, which means it's playful. And I now go and buy a puppy. To give me a better ingredient, let's say that the one I have at home is a female, and I go and buy a male puppy. That will give me a greater chance of getting dog-to-dog aggression. Doesn't mean I will, but it will give me a greater possibility. So I've already got a female, she's three, I bring in a puppy, and the puppy starts to grow up, they become bonded. So what will that puppy think when we take him out for a walk, when another male dog comes over and flirts with his female? It's called intermale aggression, isn't it? See, we set ourselves up for failure. And I buy one of the same breed. Oh no, same breed. Because you can get something called breed discrimination. The person in the northeast of England started up puppy socialization classes just for German Shepherd puppies. And they were fine in the community with other German Shepherds. Hated boxers, hated anything like a German wire-haired pointer, but they're fine with other German Shepherds. Okay, so I've got this puppy now, I bring it in, it's come away from its mother, away from its litter mates, it speaks canine language, I put it in the fly in my house. Who's it going to bond to the quickest, me or the other dog? Well, bond to the other dog. Which is, and owners say things to me like, I was so pleased when we got the puppy, I didn't know how the older dog would take to it, but they get on like a house, oh great. Should be getting on like a house on fire with you, not the other puppy, not the other dog. And they play games together, watch how they play. If you watch how your young dog plays with other dogs, if you have an aggression problem, that's what you're seeing, if you end up with an aggression problem. So German Shepherds, they like to bully other dogs, don't they? Border Collies like to nip another dog either on the hind legs or on the rear end, or it's facial depending on the type of Border Collie. We got Dobermans, it will be a middle of the back bite. I give you every breed, and how, if you have aggression, how the dog will display that aggression, and it's done based on the way they play. So I can usually tell if someone says, you know, I've got a dog-to-dog aggression problem with my German Shepherd, and I see the dog, I say, you have another German Shepherd at home, don't you? Because I watch. I can also tell you sometimes with your German Shepherd, you've got a Border Collie at home, haven't you? Because that's the influence in its behaviour. Remember, a dog doesn't just suddenly wake up one morning and decide it would be fun to fight with another dog. There's a pattern in it. And the first pattern starts with attraction towards other dogs. So I'm now raising a dog, and his role model is another dog. And I know owners will say, but my other dog is okay with other dogs. That's the problem. Your other dog's okay with dogs. That's the problem. If he wasn't, you probably wouldn't have got a puppy. And even if you did, the puppy would probably not be non-dog aggressive, because that one would have stopped him being aggressive, wouldn't it? It would have stopped him playing outrageous games. So do you want you to think about this concept? My puppy, Border Collie puppy, is now 7 months of age. I take him out in the local park on a walk. He sees other dogs and he wants to run towards them and say hello. That would devastate me, because I want to be his friend. If I wanted a dog to have dog friends, I'd just own a feral dog. So I want to be his friend, so that would hurt me a little bit. He runs off to play with all the other dogs. And when I call him back, he doesn't respond, because he doesn't understand my language, remember? So I'd be, Rover, come! And he turns and looks around, looks back at the other dog, says, there's someone shouting there. I don't know what he's saying, I don't understand him. Sorry, what were you saying? And they hold a long conversation, don't they? It shouldn't be like that. It should be, another dog comes over to say hi, and your dog should be able to say, oh, hello, are you new to the area? Yeah, my name is, oh, you must excuse me, my owner's just called me. That's how it should be, shouldn't it? But increasingly around the world, that's not how it is. Go to Beijing in China, they've still got it like that. See, a dog will stop, perhaps stop to pee, and the owner, no training classes, the owner will say, hey, come on, and the dog, boom, immediately it's there with them. Okay, so my little Border Collie puppy is now 7.5 months of age, and he's attracted to other dogs. And he runs up to them, and watch how he plays with other dogs. If all the other dogs in the community accept that sort of play, that sort of rough play, I'll never have an aggression problem, will I? But what if one objects? What if one of the dogs that he approaches like that objects to the way that he's been approached and goes, ah, now I've got aggression. And it happens in less than 5 seconds. That's how we train dogs to bite. I teach bite work training for organizations around the world. It starts as a game. And we add the word aggression.
So yeah, I would agree, it still needs another dog to spark that. And you'll see it spread like wildfire through the community now.
So the owner says, listen to the magic words, started with my dog 7.5 months of age, when another dog, and that's because he ran up to another dog, he tried to play and the other dog objected. It was your dog's fault. Don't blame the other dog. Your dog's fault. And then the owner says, now when I take him out, if I know the other dog, and he knows the other dog, it's fine, I let him off and he'll play with them. But if I don't know the other dog, I don't let him off the lead because I don't know which ones he'll play with and which ones will... So in other words, you don't know anything about your dog. You create that pattern of behavior, you alone. It wasn't the other dogs that I create. And you'll see, you only need three or four in the community to start doing that. They teach all the other dogs how to do it. If your dog had no interest in other dogs would leave it alone. If it had no interest. And you can raise a dog to have no interest in other dogs. But a lot of people now, their thinking is different. They want their dog to be friendly to other dogs. So we had a woman come on a course very recently, not here, and she had a poodle. And she said to me, my poodle's not very good around other dogs. I want him to be better. I want him to be able to play with other dogs. But he's not very good around other dogs. He seems a little bit worried about them and then he will have a snap at them. I said, why do you want your dog to play with other dogs? And she said, well, they should play with others of their own species, shouldn't they? And I said, you need to think about the dog. The dog is telling you he doesn't want to play with other dogs. And the more you're trying to make him play with other dogs, the more you're upsetting him. Why don't you play with him? He doesn't need to play. And he's telling you he does not need to play with other dogs. And you think that by keep socializing him, taking him to places, eventually he'll learn to do it. I'd much rather see owners play with their dogs than dogs playing with one another. So again, let you know another secret. I do huge numbers of court cases in the UK. I'm doing them even when I'm traveling. You know, solicitors, lawyers get in touch with me. I forget how many we had last year, but injuries relating to dogs have gone through the roof in the UK. Not all to do with aggression. In a lot of cases, it's two dogs running around playing in a public area and the one that's in front being chased playfully by the one behind crashes into someone and injures them. There's been a dramatic increase in that type of injury in the UK. Dogs out of control in a public place playing with one another with no concern for humans. Massive increase. We all have to be more responsible about our dogs. We all have to keep them under better control. Remember, if we don't, our local governments will make sure that we keep them under better control and more leash laws come in. So I just want you to think about this concept. If your dog is on the leash, no other dog should be allowed to come up and bother it. If your dog is off leash, you must ensure your dog, when you're passing anyone with another dog, you must call it back and put it on a leash out of respect for other people in your community. It is not acceptable to let your dog off. It runs up to other dogs, bothers the other dogs. You can't call it back. That is completely unacceptable. The dog that is running up towards might have a problem and you're now making that dog's problem worse. If we help one another in the community, an awful lot more, you'd find that we wouldn't have dogs that were banned. So I'm just getting you to think about a completely different way of looking at your dog. Now what we're going to look at is let's go back to problem behavior. Because I'm fascinated why a dog can end up in a shelter and then go to something like customs in the UK and end up protecting our borders when someone thought it was useless. I want you to think, whatever dog you've got, I want you to think about when you first got it. If you got it as a puppy, even more important, when you first got it. If you got it from a shelter, when you first got it. Okay? And you were driving it home, probably. You would have an idea in your mind what you wanted that dog to grow into, either from the shelter or from as a puppy. So, I don't know, you might want it to have a great dog you could take hiking out on trails, a dog that you could ski with, a great dog to raise your family with, a dog that you wanted to do some kind of a dog sport with, a great dog to take out hunting. Okay, that's what you wanted. So everyone will have that picture in their mind when they get a puppy or they go to the shelter and they get their dog. I've never met anyone in the world when they got the puppy who had the idea, I want him to be able to donate to a shelter by the time he's 10 months of age. So if we accept that nobody has ever anywhere in the world specifically purchased a puppy to donate to a shelter later in life, obviously something's gone wrong, hasn't it, in the relationship. And that's a relationship problem. I'll tell you why the relationship went wrong. Nobody actually looked at what the puppy wanted in life. That's where the relationship goes wrong. It was all one way. So you wanted, sorry, don't you, you personally, but the owner wanted something from the puppy, but they were prepared to give nothing in return except food. And a lot of people now believe, if I feed this particular diet, I must be a good owner, because that's what the pet food manufacturer is telling you. Okay, I don't know any puppy at the point you purchased it, or any dog that comes from a shelter, that would look at you on that drive home and say, I want to be fed exactly the same food every day for the rest of my life. That has to be the cruelest thing you can ever do to a dog. And yet the pet food manufacturers have actually convinced us that's what you have to do. You don't have to believe them, you know. You don't have to believe any of that. So my family is a Welsh farming family, border collies working 75 miles a day. They weren't fed on that sort of stuff. What were they fed? Leftovers that the family had eaten. So they weren't fed that at all. They weren't fed these high performance foods. I don't know of any Newfoundland that would dream of never being allowed to go swimming. I don't know of any beagle that would dream of being kept on the lead for the rest of its life. Because you can't let them off because they don't come back, do they? Okay, just remember, we do not have a breed of dog that will not return when called genetically. And if we had, well, we wouldn't have them now because they'd all run away, wouldn't they, and not come back. Okay? So dogs have come into our lives. So that's why it's so simple to teach a dog to come back when called, as everyone found on the course. 200, let me just explain, the recall that we did, and anyone who's here on the course will confirm this, the recall we did on the final day, 200, it was in excess of 250 yards, no fences, and we had the owner in a area with those bales of hay, dog, horse poop all over the floor, frozen, which is a particular delicacy for dogs. We padlocked them to a fence, and we put the key on the dog's collar 250 yards away. And we released the dog, and if the dog didn't get to him, we were going to leave him there. All 20, just after 3 days of training, all 20 dogs ran and released their owners. And only ate the horse poop after they released their owners. But it's true, it's true, that is true. Okay, so it's training. When we get a puppy, we have to train it on what we want it to do. So that drive home, I'm going to ask you to think carefully about this. Don't anyone shout the answers out. I want you to think about this. In a typical day in your dog's life, typical day, today probably not typical, could you give me a list of all the things in a typical day that you give your dog to look forward to? What do you give it look forward to every day? You should be able to think of 10 things. Okay, it's sad if you can't think of anything. That means you've never considered the dog. That's why some dogs become problems. Okay, so do they look forward to being fed? Yeah. How many times a day do you feed? Two, so twice. Let me give you a little bit of advice. If you want a better relationship with your dog, now feed it four times a day. Don't feed it four times the amount. It actually gives the dog four things. What else do they look forward to? Going out for a walk? Yeah, dogs do like to go out for a walk. If you don't take your dog out for a walk, I would again question why you've got a dog. Then charities in the UK, shelters in the UK, they'll often ask the owner the question, do you have a fully enclosed backyard? And they won't actually allow you to have a dog unless you have a fully enclosed backyard. I would never adopt a dog out to someone who had a fully enclosed backyard. It becomes a prisoner. If you don't have a fully enclosed backyard, you've got to go out with it, haven't you? That's why we get dogs. So if you take the dog out for a walk once a day, I'd suggest for an hour, I'd suggest you stop doing that and take it out four times a day for 15 minutes. Four things to look forward to with you. I would suggest that you teach your dog to play with you with a toy. And don't do it once a day, do it four times a day. See, I give you lists now where your dog will actually do whatever you want because you're providing it with things it wants in life. You know, it's no good complaining about the dog, he won't do as I tell him. The dog looks at you and says, you don't do anything for me in return. All you do is feed me. And depending on your breed, there should be a highlight of your dog's week. You have a highlight of your week. What's your dog's highlight of the week? That would be breed dependent. Say, Newfoundland Golden Retriever should be swimming. Beagle should be tracking. Doesn't mean if you got a Shar Pei it needs to go fighting once a week. You'd invent games that you can play with a dog that give it an outlet for that instinct. The great thing about the USA is you have more dog activities than most other countries in the world. Terriers, there's barn hunting, isn't there? You've got canine nose work where the dogs like to use their nose. You've got tracking. There's all kinds of things you can do. See, if I owned a beagle, I've got two choices. I know when I get him, most of his behavior is going to be dictated by his nose. So I know if I take him out, there's been rabbits or hares, which is what the dog is designed to go and hunt. And they don't run very fast because they were hunted on foot, unlike the long-legged hounds that were hunted on horseback. So they don't run very fast. And the basset hound, that's for French people who couldn't hardly run at all, wasn't it? Walking speed. Okay, so I know with my beagle that he's going to about 4 months of age, if he's off the lead and picks up a particular scent, he is likely to follow it. They say with a beagle it's not failed a recall till it's been gone for 3 days. Okay, I understand that about the breed. What I can do is train my puppy to follow a track that I lay or my children lay so we can play a game of hide and seek. That beagle will look at me and say, you're the best owner I could ever have. You're allowing me to do something that I was instinctively bred to do. Think about keeping it on the lead and never letting it off. In case it goes off hunting, that dog will look at you and say, you're the worst person I could ever be paired with. I want you to think about your own dog. When you got it, did you understand the instincts? Did you train the dog so you could control it? A border collie, we don't stop the instinct, it's just controlled. The dog's given an outlet every day running around the sheep, and it's simply controlled. So I want you to think about the breed of dog you have. If you have a behavior problem, that's the first thing we'd look at. Because to change behavior, you've got to give the dog some kind of an alternative. You've got to give him a reason to change his behavior. So, example, I tell the dog to get off the couch. I try to get him off and he growls at me. Okay, it's a very common one in the UK. Remember the first question, what do you give your dog to look forward to every day on a daily basis? And the owner can't think of anything. I can show you how to train the dog to get off the couch just like that, if we can think of a reward that the dog gets for getting off the couch. And don't please think of food. Okay? Become one of the problems that we now have in training. People think the only way you can train a dog is by using food. You know, you go to a training class, 20 different ways to feed a dog, that's all it is. Okay, we do it based on relationships. So just as an example, when you feed your dog, so when you put the food down, and I'm going to assume when you put the food down, do you actually ask it to do anything for you, or do you just put the food down? This is how we teach. If you want an amazing relationship with your dog, that makes it really easy to train. Amazing relationship. When you put the food down, you're going to tell him to sit. Okay? And when he sits, you're going to tell him he is the most wonderful dog ever in the world. So it'd be sit, good boy, good boy. Make him look at you, smile, let him know you're it, and then let him eat the food. Okay? Everything that you do with your dog, when you're going to give him something, just get him to do something for you, but tell him how much you appreciate that. It teaches him your emotional behavior. Okay? That's very important, because we're going to come back to dog-to-dog aggression in a minute. If your dog doesn't understand even that emotion, you'll never solve a problem of dog-to-dog aggression. He has to understand and be able to communicate with you. So do that for a week. When you're going to take him out for a walk, get him to sit and tell him how wonderful he is before you then take him out for a walk. And after a week of doing that, remember 10 things on your list. After a week of doing that, now we're going to take him out for a walk, and I'm going to get him, instead of just getting him to sit, I'm going to get him to sit and count to 20. Watch. So we get him to sit. Good boy. 1, 2, good boy. Watch what happens if he moves after 15 seconds. Good. Oh, I can't believe you did that. I'm not going to go out for a walk now. I'm going to go and watch television. In no time at all, you'll have taught the dog two emotions. If you're happy, yes, he can do anything at all. He gets anything he wants. If he makes you unhappy, he loses something. You now control him around any other dog. Just those two emotions. Most of the dogs I meet that have dog-to-dog aggression problems do not even understand that. Just think about the concept. You're my dog and you understand me, you can communicate with me. I walk you past another dog and you behave badly and I go, oh, I wish you wouldn't do that. That really, really upsets me. I haven't been angry with you, I've just turned away in disgust. And you understand that. Oh, what's upset him? Oh, sorry. And you walk past the next dog, and I say, I think you're the best dog in the world. Why would you then want to go for another dog? It's a thing that most dog-to-dog aggression problems have in common. They don't understand it. Leash aggression, they just don't know how to walk properly on the leash. If they don't walk perfectly on a leash when there's no other dogs around, it won't suddenly get better when there are other dogs around. And leash aggression is just frustration, wants to get at the other dog. Most of them don't want to get the other dog to kill it. They want to go and play with it, don't they? And because they're on the lead, they can't. And that's where we get... The dogs aren't lunging because they want the other dog to go away. They're trying to get a hold of it. So it doesn't go away. That's very different. I remember going to a shelter once, and they had a black Labrador in one of the kennels, and the staff had put a notice on it: "Do not put your fingers in; this dog will bite." I looked at the dog; it didn't look like he would bite. I was talking to the dog; he's wagging his tail, looked happy. So of course I put my. If they hadn't put the notice there, I'd never thought of putting my fingers in. I put my fingers in, and he bit me. But he didn't bite me because he didn't want my finger. He bit me and held on because he didn't want me to go away. A lot of the dog-to-dog reactivity is that behavior, because the dog doesn't want the other dog to be taken away. It's not because they're frightened of other dogs. If they're frightened of other dogs, they'd be very quiet and hide behind their owners, wouldn't they? But if they see another dog and they start going, whoa, 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 it means I'm here, come closer, come closer. Okay, remember, some people say to me, he does it because he's frightened of other dogs. There's a test. Let the dog off the lead, walk another dog towards it. If your dog will leave your side and run 20 yards to mix it with another dog, I'm going to say he's probably not frightened of the other dog, is he? And then owners say, off the lead, he's okay with other dogs. It's only when he's on the lead. Well, you taught him that. You taught that behavior. If you hadn't let him have so much fun playing with other dogs in the beginning, he wouldn't get frustrated when you hold him and don't let him play with other dogs. So I want you to think about this concept. I'll give you the complete fix for dog-to-dog aggression. Turn yourself into your dog's best friend and teach the dog how to communicate with you. It's not difficult. Take you 5 weeks. Separate your dog from all other dogs for 5 weeks, even the other dog at home, and teach it your language. Turn yourself into its best friend. Teach it how to communicate with you. When you've done that, you'll see a remarkable transformation in your dog now becoming part of your family, instead of being a bit of a liability in the dog that you own. Dogs don't have a concept of ownership. It's only people who have that concept. So you can change it around, but it does take usually 5 weeks. Next time you get a puppy, it will take you 5 weeks. That's the secondary socialization period. You can teach it to bond you. So, just to... yep.
Do you have this information?
I've just given it to you.
No, but... I've got a dog in 7 months, and he's dog-aggressive.
Yep.
I manage it very well, and he's pretty much only with me. I don't walk with
him. Oh, it's an easy one, then. If it's, so, you don't own other dogs?
I don't.
Okay, and he... Okay, and he doesn't go to doggy daycare?
He does go to doggy daycare.
Okay, stop immediately. I'd stop that instantly. That's first thing.
Okay.
Because he's practicing the very games that you don't want him to play.
Okay,
so that would be the first thing I stop. I'm not saying no dog should ever go to doggy daycare.
He goes once a week.
Yeah. Okay, next 5 weeks he doesn't.
Okay.
And it's now an easy one. Does he come when you call him?
Yeah, he's good about that.
100%. So if he's chasing... Okay. Lindsay will show you how to get... Actually, anyone who's on my course, they will help you get 100% on your recall. Anyone who's on the course. So just ask around. So that's first thing. If he comes when called. The next thing is, if you have a really good bond with him... So if he was in here, and I held on to him, complete stranger, and you walked out that door, would he be worried?
He'd worry.
Great. Well, it's easy then. Okay, this is what we do. Very quick and simple. So I'm someone that the dog hardly knows, okay? And we'd go for a walk. So I've got the dog, I'm holding him on the lead, okay? And we bring another dog in, and I'm watching him carefully. As soon as I see his level of, not when he's at the end of the lead doing anything, as soon as I see him become interested in the other dog, this is all we do. When I say now, you're going to scream, run, get in your car, and I want to see smoke coming from your tires. As I just gently, just one pull towards the other dog, and it will spin around and go, where have you gone? And you just stay away. It usually only takes about a minute. And then when you come back, just get hold of him. And you walk towards the other dog. And as soon as he spots the other dog, you look at you, don't leave. Okay, you can do it like that if you only own one dog. If you own more than one dog, it's going to take at least 5 weeks to build that sort of relationship that you have to stop that behavior with other dogs. So you can do it. Actually, with your dog, it usually would take me about 15, 20 minutes. We did it on a course in Oregon.
I've been working for 2 years.
Yeah, but what you've been doing is trying to feed him when he sees other dogs. True?
Amongst other things.
Yeah.
I've tried a lot, so.
Okay.
And if you continue that, so the idea, the theory sounds good, doesn't it? So when you spot another dog 500 miles away, you then get his attention and feed him. And then after like 6 years, you now get the other dog 40 miles away. And that actually, it does work. I'm sort of joking a little bit, but that system can work. But the problem is, first of all, the only food that he gets should be for that. There should be no other food in his life. And that's cruel, isn't it? That's the only way it can work. Because you still feed them at home at 6 o'clock, so that food is not that important, is it? So that's why I don't use that system. Not that it can't work, but for it to work, that's the only food the dog eats. Like they train the killer whales, marine mammals, it's done the same way. So by separating from other dogs, certainly not doggy daycare, and teaching him that when he spots another dog and wants to play his little game with it, at that point, before he's at the end of the lead, if he then believes that and he's a rescue dog, so this is easy. When you turn away and go, that he's never going to see you again, that's called a significant traumatic experience. It won't damage your relationship with the dog at all. He will love you even more.
How can I do this without somebody else? Could I like tie him to
a tree? No, nothing like that. No, Lindsay will help you. She'll do it with you. Sorry, Lindsay, I just volunteered you with that. But we did with the dog in Oregon. It was on a completely different course. But the woman was, well, I had to do something because otherwise, you know, other people on the course were complaining. It wasn't anything to do with aggression, but I had to do something with the dog. And I got an email up. Two things. First of all, the dog didn't walk properly on the lead anyway. So we quickly showed it how to walk properly on the lead. And then we did this. We only did it once. And that dog was absolutely fine for the rest of the time. And I got an email from about 2 weeks later saying, I can't believe how it's changed my dog. He's now not interested in other dogs. When another dog comes up, he looks to me quickly. And then you can reward him, give him a food treat if you want. You know, say good boy, but don't get him excited. So all that works really well. But again, you know, I'd set it up. So I'd do it, you know the other dog and owner, you know, make sure that dog's bomb-proof. But it has to be done before. You don't wait until he is a high level of arousal, because nothing works then anyway. If your dog does take a pop at another dog, by the way, you're too late. So it's now damage limit. The dog won't learn any new behaviors, but this is just damage limitation. The best thing to do is get your dog away from the other dog, get it to do something you want for at least 2 minutes before you ever reward it. So you see some people in the class, don't you? The dog takes a pop at the other dog, the instructor says, okay, pull him back, get him to sit, watch me, give him a food treat. And so the dog says, the most reliable way of getting the food treats is going for other dogs. He's made the connection. Okay, the rule is, sit. If he goes for another dog, pull him away, sit, up, don't do that, sit, stay, down, sit, stand, down, sit, heel, sit, 2 minutes, then reward him. Now he's getting rewarded for what you wanted, not for going for the other dog, if that makes sense. Any more questions? Oh, we didn't leave enough time for questions. Yeah. Do one at the back there, yeah.
And she's been great, but she takes
a part of the. Oh, you haven't tried the one thing that will work. I've no idea what that is, but no. Okay, the chases cars. I've done this so many times. Listen to it. The thing I hate the most about doing this is people will go away and then talk about what they think I said. Okay, that's why I actually prefer people to tape record what I say. Okay, this is what we do. It's a chasing behavior. So what the dog is going to do is chase the car, and when the car gets a certain distance from you or from wherever home is, the dog then breaks off and comes back. And we have two types of chasing. We call them headers and heelers. The ones that try to get in front of the truck, and they're rewarded every time because the person puts their foot on the brake, which is what the dog wants. And we have healers, they see it in the rear view mirror and they go faster, which is what the dog wants. So I could do the joke, you know, so when the dog gets in front, instead of putting your foot on the brake, put it on the gas pedal, fix his problem, but I won't do that. Okay, this is all we do. This is all we do. You need someone in the car. So, you know, pick a car that the dog's like to chase. You want someone in the car. Teach it to come back when called, by the way, first. And you have the person in the passenger side, you're on the right-hand side, aren't you? The person on the passenger side, they've got a long line which comes out the window and is attached to the dog's collar. Okay? So you'd sit on the rear seat if you want, but on that side of the car. So you've got the dog attached by a line. And the car is then parked back here. So we've got our dog here now. I've got it on a line. And you go slowly, 6 miles an hour, and drive past the dog. And if the dog starts to chase the car, just get them to tighten up the line and keep going. Usually half a mile does the trick. When the dog realizes it can't get away from the car, they won't ever chase another car after that. But you've got to do it on a very quiet road. We had a Rottweiler in Texas that was chasing trucks and actually puncturing the rear wheels while the truck was moving, which is a bit dangerous. And I sat in the back of the truck, we had a line on, drove the truck past, the dog comes chasing up, and I just simply hold on to the dog. And we actually drove for a mile. And remember, we're only going slow, you're not like dragging the dog bouncing on his back along the road. But after, I don't know, probably 300 yards, the dog tried to turn around and go back, and it found it couldn't, and then start crying and crying. And when we let go, you can see, I swear, you see flames come from its feet as it's hiking it back to the property. I do it a lot in Belgium because we have dogs that chase cyclists, a very popular sport in Belgium. Exactly the same. Just let the dog do it and say, okay, that's the last you'll ever see me again. And we usually get the owner to scream at the point where the dog is going to start turning, get the owner to scream and go in the other direction. They think twice. But remember, you've got a dog that likes to chase, you must get it to chase toys. You must get the dog to chase toys and control it. Because otherwise it's just cruel, isn't it? You've got a dog that's been born to chase things and you're saying you mustn't chase anything. It wouldn't ever achieve that. You've got to transfer it onto a toy so the dog gets as much pleasure, in more pleasure out of chasing a toy than it does cars. Because cars are dangerous. Yeah, another one.
Just playing with a dog,
yeah.
Having that playtime, is it retrieving, is it pulling, is it tugging, what are the things?
A dollar bill. Just play with your dog with a dollar bill, because first of all, it'll only cost you a dollar. And if you've got a breed, pit bull terrier, Rottweiler, that likes to play tugging games, I guarantee you'll teach it to play very gently. And then the question is, well, I've tried to play with my dog, but he keeps chewing it up, swallowing it. What do? Switch to $5. If he still does it, switch to 10. And then if he still does it, switch to 20, then 50. At some stage, you'll stop it, won't you? In other words, you'll teach the dog what you want it to do. And you'll still get it to play the game. So, I've never, ever found a dog anywhere in the world that I can't get to play and retrieve. Anywhere in the world, any breed, any age, never found one. It's not the toy that's as important as you being a playmate. Down on your hands and knees, having fun with the dog, and genuinely having fun with the dog. And we found paper is about the best thing. Throw it up in the air, get the dog to catch it, rip it apart. You know, it's called, again, it's allelomimetic behavior. If you went to somewhere where there was sand, or here, snow, you got on your hands and knees, started digging, what would your dog do? Yeah. So you get on your hands and knees, play with a piece of paper and rip it up, what will your dog do? It will play the game. And then from that, once you've got him playing with the toy, you teach retrieve. Not difficult. Dog training, honestly, 1754, when the guy said dog training is an art that's easily acquired, it really is. But it will only ever be an art. What's happened recently is people tried to turn it into a science. And it will never be a science. It will always be an art form. And we're losing our ability to communicate with animals, not just dogs, because we're not actually raising our kids with dogs anymore. They don't learn it in school. We're segregating more and more kids from our dogs. Shelters all around the world, remember, some countries don't have shelters because they're not needed. In America and the UK, shelters is massive business. And with the number of dog trainers we have, compared to what we had 100 years ago, the number of behaviors we have, why aren't we shutting shelters down? You know, if I run a shelter, my business plan for the next 10 years will be to close it within 10 years because it wasn't needed, because I get education in the community. And in this community, it wouldn't be difficult. You know, you have lots of dogs, you've got lots of trails, and you've got lots of opportunities to educate. But don't educate pet dog owners in facilities. You educate them out there. That's where it's needed. You know, don't go to training classes or don't run training classes that teach recall in the hall, that teach dogs to walk properly on a lead in here. It has to be done in the community, and it's very important that everyone in the community sees that we are training dogs to be better in the community. If you see that, they'll open up more trails to people who have dogs. But please don't open the dog park. Your community should be the dog park. Okay. To the bar. Yeah, go on, one more.
I have King Setters.
All right, yeah, I know the breed really well.
Yeah. I just wonder what your opinion is about e-collars.
About?
E-collars. Do you use them at all?
I would never ever use one under any circumstances because they're not necessary.
Okay.
If it was necessary, I'd be the first person in the world to say, you know, there might be some circumstance under which you'd use them. It's completely unnecessary. We just had our first prosecution in Wales. Someone who used an invisible fence, you know, with a shock collar on the dog, and he was convicted of cruelty, a $10,000 fine. And the judge in his summing up said, and the judge wasn't a dog lover or a dog owner, the judge in his summing up said, if you're too lazy to build up a proper fence or take your dog out yourself, you shouldn't be torturing the poor animal. That's supposed to be part of your family.